watching Poindexter Lounge. You already know. You're watching Poindexter Lounge for the Unity.
Why don't you set aside an hour or two? We'll have a few drinks and a cup of coffee I don't drink.
What's up, nerd family? Welcome once again to the Poindexter Lounge. My name is Enosh, aka Enosh Fett, and it is good to have you with me in the lounge today. Now, look, if this is your first time to the lounge, it's good to have you here. It's good to have you here. I'm glad that you stopped by. I'm glad that that you decided to give us a shot, which puts a lot of pressure on us because if you're giving us a shot for the first time, and maybe you've heard of the lounge, maybe you haven't, and now I have to make sure that I'm funny, witting, entertaining, and informative all at the same time. And that's a lot of pressure. And I don't know if I can, you know what? I'm sorry, folks. I don't think I can do this then. Thanks for coming. Just kidding. Hey, welcome to the Poindexter Lounge. If this is your first time to the lounge, just know that the lounge is a place for nerds. It's a place where you and me, I always get that wrong. Anyways, it's a place where we can get together and talk about the things that we love. Things like TV shows, movies, games, sci-fi, fantasy, comic books, superheroes, toys, and so much more. And if those are things that get you excited, if those are things that get you scouring Twitter for every little bit of information and picture and, you know, and looking at Vero, just hanging on every word that Zack Snyder says, no, we don't do that, folks. But you know what? You found the right place. And so we're so glad to have you guys here and so glad that you decided to spend some time with us tonight because it's a Saturday night. Well, it's no longer Saturday night. Now it's Sunday morning for me. But whatever it is, wherever you are, it is good to see you. It's good to see you all here. And I'm glad that you decided to spend some time with us tonight. And you know what? Here's the thing about the Poindexter Lounge. Okay. You never know what's going to happen on this channel. You never know what's going to happen in a broadcast. You never know who might show up. You never know who might make an appearance. You never know what might happen, what might be said, you know, what's going to happen like live during the show, because we have a lot of fun here. And so we're just glad that you guys are here. Anyways, it is, so I got a haircut. Yeah. A haircut. Look at that. Like all short and everything. Although, because it's not brushed out because it's been under a hat. If I do this, I kind of look like Beaker from the Muppets. Or I could, you know, I used to get Kramer a lot when I was a kid from Seinfeld. But when it's brushed down, it looks, you know, it looks nice. It looks good like that. But hey, yeah, got a haircut. My hats fit a lot better now and all that good jazz. I never had a mullet, but for some reason people thought I had a mullet, you know, because I had longer hair back here, but whatever. And you didn't come here for that. But I just thought I'd tell you, I got a haircut and it feels good and I feel right. I feel right. Anyways, good to see you guys here tonight. Let's see who's here real quick before we bring in our panel and we talk about the stuff that we're going to talk about. Let's jump in. The Junk Man is here. That Junk Man, I should say. That Junk Man, good to see you here. It is so good that you are here tonight. We're going to have That Junk Man here for sure sometime in the next little while, and we're going to talk some Star Wars and action figures and stuff with him. That Sean C. Yes. Sean C says, saw the 10th anniversary screening of Scott Pilgrim last night. Heck yeah. Legit. My new favorite theater experience. If you have screenings near you, go see it ASAP. It's only showing for a week. I might have to check that out. I love that movie. What's up, Geek Studios? Always good to see you, man, in here. RJ is in here. Zeno is in here. Good to see you, Zeno. Watched Man of Steel last night. It was pretty awesome. Always love to hear that. Heck yeah. Oh my Diaz, good to see you in here, Eddie. I always say this wrong. Ife? Man of Steel is dope. Heck yeah, it is. It is absolutely dope. in every way. T.W. McKay is up in here. Darth Tasty is up in here. I referenced you, man, the other night. He says, definitely not making pizza rolls. He's always late. Heck yeah. I was actually on time, but I had to excuse myself to take care of something that I didn't want to have to do during the show. Just letting you know. No, Darth Tasty, it's funny. I thought of you the other night. I made a reference to me being tasty. I said, I'm not Darth Tasty, but I'm a tasty morsel myself. Music Man, always good to see you. Just got off work. Awesome, man. I hope you're doing well as well. Mary Wilcox is in the house for sure. Stella, good to see you. Stella! I worked with a girl named Stella once, and every time she walked by, I would yell that, Stella! Stella, Jeff Blatfelty, good to see you in here. Barcy is in here. Good to see Barcy. Nick Hammond. Oh, heck yeah. Baby girl. Good to see you in here. Who else is in here? Before my StreamYard starts jumping around, I knew it was going to do that. As soon as I started to back off, I saw it do it. Ryan, always good to see you. If Eraserhead had a brother. Nice. Yeah, somebody else mentioned that just a minute ago, the whole Eraserhead thing. Yep. Okay, good to see you in here. Movie Madness, what's up, Max? Good to see you, sir. Let's see. Stiff Mice, whoops, or Cylon Scotty, be nice to your toasters, everyone. We can't promise that we won't damage a toaster tonight. You know how it is. Stiff Meister, always good to see you. How many hot toys do you have? I've got technically two. Because Max, Mad Max Entertainment there, he purchased them for me and is sending them to me. But I don't get them till next year, you know, because of the Zack Snyder Justice League ones that are coming. So thank you, Max, for that. What's up, Ben? Good to see you, Ben. Let's see. Darkseid is here. Whoop, it's not letting me click on stuff. Darkseid is here. Good to see you, Darkseid. You know, it can be scary when Darkseid shows up, but you know, we're prepared. We're staring down a boom tube at each other, but we're smiling. 187 in the house. Yes, geeks, we have the Discord. I thought you knew about the Discord. I don't know. I'd have to send myself a link here. Maybe I'll do that here in the next few minutes after we bring a couple people in and people get talking and I can, you know, do other things at the same time when I'm doing the show. So, it's a good night. It's a good day. And there's lots to talk about. And we're going to talk about some of that stuff tonight here in Enosh Fett and his amazing echo chamber of Snyderverse, staying positive with everything and people with other opinions too. And tonight, of course, we are talking about these Wayne T. Carr photos. And you know what? We'll talk about a lot of other stuff too, because we always do. But it is so good to have you guys. Also, thank you to all of our patrons. You guys are fantastic. We appreciate each and every one of you. And of course, all of our members here at the channel. Thank you guys for all that you do. Thank you guys for being awesome. We appreciate you. All right. That being said, we're going to jump right in and we're going to start talking. We're going to start having some fun. Ladies and gentlemen, you've come to love him here on the channel. You had a good time with him. And he's become a voice of reason sometimes here in, you know, between me and Matt Jarvo. By the way, I don't know. It was kind of funny. I was on Max's stream the other night. And I think people thought that I was like mad at Matt or something. I'm not mad at Matt. You know, Matt has an opinion about the Snyderverse stuff right now. And that's fine. Like, I am not mad at Matt. Like, I was just ribbing him. We had been ribbing each other. You guys got to understand, there's sometimes that there's a lot of us who stream together. We have these inside jokes and we have like these, you know, private threads that we kind of, you know, tease each other and razz each other and stuff. And I had been razzing Matt earlier in the day. So when I saw him on Max's stream, I was just continuing to razz him about his, you know, stuff with, you know, the Snyderverse is God is dead, you know, it's done, whatever. And I know a lot of people were giving him a hard time. That was not what that was about, but I just wanted to make that clear. Anyways, it is good to have this guy in here tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the channel, Mr. RJ, Resident Justice. What's up, RJ?
Hey, what's up, everybody? Doing all right.
Heck yeah. Good to see you, man. Always good to see you, bro.
Absolutely. Love being here as always.
All right. Hey, what's up? Sophie in the house says, hey, Enosh and chat. Hope everyone's having a good weekend. I am having a good weekend. I slept a lot today. No, I mean, when I said I slept a lot, like I got up even and I still slept on the couch, RJ. Like I just slept and slept and slept. I turned on South Park.
It's
on
been
HBO
like
Max.
That for me the last couple of days because like I haven't been getting too much great sleep because I've been like, you know, grinding on streams and stuff. It's like, oh yeah, I need to actually like take care of my sleep schedule a little bit.
Well, you all know that you know, I'm the hardest working streamer, you know, going, man. I'm streaming every day, man, doing the pulling the third shift stuff. So today though, I caught up on so much sleep. I just, oh my gosh. Sophie says, don't feel bad. I slept until 3 p.m. Yeah, I got up at about five. No, I'm sorry. So I got up at like two, got up, got something to eat, sat on the couch, turned on South Park, woke up again at five. Slept some more. Tiffany came down. We were going to watch something together. And then I slept until like 10. So I'm pretty well rested right now and ready to go for this stream. So I got lots of energy and I'm ready to go. All right, ladies and gentlemen, moving right along. Ladies and gentlemen, you love him. You like his takes. It's been a while since he's been on here just because he's been busy doing other stuff. He's been, I don't know where he's been actually. I mean, you know, we talk to him every once in a while, but, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. T.W. McKay, what's up?
Hi, how's it going?
You sleeping too?
No.
You sleeping too?
Yeah. No, like I said in the private chat, I slept till about 3 o'clock myself, so I did nothing today. Well, I mean, I like did my bed sheets, but that's about it.
Hey.
Sometimes you just need that on a day off, you know what I mean?
You do. And then, ladies and gentlemen, yes, go ahead.
No, I was just saying, you just need days where you do nothing at all. You're all good.
Absolutely. That, you know, there ain't nothing wrong with that. You know, the older you get, you start thinking like, oh man, I don't have days to waste. You know, like when I was, you know, younger, you know, and it's just like, ah, yeah, I'll sleep until five. No problem. You know, you know, now you're like, that was a day of my life. I'll never get back. How many days like that? Right. But, all right. So now there's just days I sleep like, you know, 1-2 hours. And I'm just like, I become the old man. I get it now. Why old people, like, they're just like, they're up constantly.
I'm only like 27 and I went for a shower after I'd done a little bit of house cleaning and I'm like, I twisted one way to grab the shampoo and I'm like, I felt something go on my back. I'm like, I'm not old, but like, why is this happening?
Don't have a Jarbo moment. TW, don't have a Jarbo moment.
You're
on painkillers for the rest of your life. And ladies and gentlemen, rounding out the panel for now until somebody else joins us maybe. Ladies and gentlemen, you love him. You're probably subscribed to him because the whole world is subscribed to him. And every time I think that this man has gone above and beyond and gone out of his way or done something that impresses me more, he just goes a little bit further. Ladies and gentlemen, he's been busy. He's been working. He's been working hard. He's been, you know, so proud of this young man. He's growing up in the world and he's out there, you know, doing an honest day's living now. And sometimes you just can't stream when you're doing that. But ladies and gentlemen, we love this guy. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the channel, Dawson.
Dawson!
It's been a while since I've seen that clip.
Oh, it's been a while since I've been able to use that clip.
Oh, man. It's good to be here. I haven't been able to be on the channel for a while just because, you know, work's been crazy. And it turns out it's only going to get more crazy this summer because we've been working like 8.5-hour shifts mostly, which, you know, is pretty good. But this summer, they're moving us to a different part of the factory and making us work 10-hour shifts and sometimes working Saturdays. And so, like, this is going to be that's fun. Well, it's like, it's both good and bad because, like, they both increase my hourly pay and they give me more hours. So it's like, well, I mean, I can't argue with that.
Ow. Stop twisting my arm. I mean, you know.
That was almost a pretty good impression of my voice, not going to lie.
No, I was, before I got on there, let me interrupt you there, sorry. You know, it's before I got on, I was just testing my microphone. Because I was looking at the chat and I'd said hey to Lord Tasty and I was like, hail Lord Tasty, and I'm like, oh god, I've done Mike Zero, I'm turning into Doomcock. Oh no.
Nice.
But speaking of sleep, I actually didn't get to sleep in too much today. I had to take my sister into town to get her phone wiped because she had a recent encounter with a scammer and they got into her phone data, and so we had to take it in, get it all cleared out and everything, and she's not used to driving into the bigger towns, so Made a little day trip out of it. Got some Chick-fil-A, which is always a good thing.
Them bigger towns. Well, I didn't have Chick-fil-A today because we don't have a Chick-fil-A near Flint. We literally have to drive over an hour. We only have, I think, three or four Chick-fil-A's in all of Michigan, which really, really? Sucks. Yeah, there's literally. Listen, I don't know what it is. I don't know if it's a regional thing. I don't know. I don't know what the deal is with that. But I'll tell you what, whoever, like every time a new restaurant, you know, like a new building gets put up in our main, you know, like, you know, thoroughfare or whatever, here by me, everybody always theorizes that it's a Chick-fil-A, you know, like, and the funny thing is this last one looked like a Chick-fil-A and everyone's like, finally, because we just keep talking about, man, the company that finally gets approved for a Chick-fil-A in this area is just going to make bank.
Yeah.
You know, and seriously, it just never happens. And so, yeah, so well, it's weird, but I didn't have Chick-fil-A, but I did have McDonald's, new chicken sandwich today, which was actually pretty good.
I'll check that out. I've had like so many different chicken sandwiches, right? Surprisingly, the best one I've had outside of Chick-fil-A, right? It was a good substitute. Is actually Zaxby's.
Zaxby's is pretty good.
Oh, whoops, I didn't mean to do that.
But like, random.
That's something I was going to talk about.
You're going to bring up like a chicken restaurant's picture or something, like just to say this is the superior chicken, you know?
No.
But basically, like we went to Chick-fil-A because it's the place we went to for to get our phone cleared is like an hour away, and that's where Chick-fil-A was, and it was right across the street from the Best Buy, which you have to wait like an hour for them to get the done. So we're like, oh, let's go get some Chick-fil-A. There's also Barnes and Noble right next door. So it's just like, okay, I'm going to go look at some books because that's just what I do. Like in the way that Enosh is a toy collector and has all those different toys, I plan to be the same with books to a certain extent. Like you should see how much my book collection has improved. In fact, I'll show you guys some of the books that I got recently. I don't know if you guys have seen them yet. Let me make this mic a little less entangled.
While you're doing that,
I will share about how a couple of things. So I'll do this for Junkman because I'm sure Junkman will appreciate this. Check out my t-shirt.
Ooh, nice.
I love this shirt, by the way. Yeah. This is my dream car right here.
Oh, really? The Bandit's your dream car?
Either that or a 1982
Trans Am?
I had an 86 Grand Am. It was my first car. and it was these colors, though. It was this gold and black. Okay. Oh, heck yeah. What was Kit?
That was a Trans Am as well.
It was a Trans Am, but I think it was like an 82 Trans Am. But anyways, I love these two cars, man. These two cars are my cars just growing up. Here's the weird thing. My friend Kevin, I've known Kevin, since I was 17 years old.
Right.
Kevin is awesome. And Kevin is one of those guys like I have watched come up. He's financially like he's a genius. I've seen that do more with money than I ever know. And like now he's into real estate and he's now that guy from like the late night TVs who does seminars and stuff, you know, like that you see, like I can teach you how to do like Kevin Reynolds. Oh, my gosh. Like he is so smart and he's got this amazing, huge house. He's got all kinds of cars and vehicles and recreation stuff. And like literally when I first met him, he was like making like $11 an hour, like stuff. But he worked under the guy who makes all the he was the personal assistant to the guy who made all of the like QS 9000 checks and balances stuff for the automotive industry. Mm-hmm. And so he just like sat under that guy and learned from him. And so now Kevin does all this stuff. Like he's met everyone by accident. He met the Rolling Stones by accident. He met David Lee Roth by accident. He's an amazing drummer. He actually produced with me my band Waking Vegas's last album, and I've recorded with him several times. Just a tremendous guy. But I posted a picture of this Trans Am not too long ago, and what's he post? He's got the freaking car. Seriously. He owns like all these storage facilities now. And he's like, oh yeah, I've got that car. And I'm like, I've never seen that car at your house, Kevin. And he's like, oh yeah, I've got it. He's like, it's in storage right now, but I've got it. And then like a couple weeks later, he's like showing me him like out driving the car. And I'm like, Kevin, I need to come down and drive that car. I just want to come down and drive that car, please. Please let me drive that car.
What's that sound? What's that sound in the distance? He's bounding down.
We're going to do what they said can't be done.
Yeah, so kid is an E2 Trans Am.
I did not know that
Glenn Larson created Knight Rider, the guy who created Battlestar Galactica. I'm like, what?
Well, dude, he created everything, man. Like back in the 80s, man. Like all that good stuff, like he created, dude. Like that was all Glenn Larson. I'll tell you, if we're gonna have this conversation, I might have to just go ahead and like invite Junkman in because that right there is that's his specialty, man. Oh, yeah. I don't know if you guys have ever watched his.
I haven't, sadly. I apologize.
Oh, you got to watch that junk, man. I'll tell you what. I just love his stuff because, man, he and I don't know what he's doing, but why isn't it? What? Twitter is acting so weird to me, man. Like, everything is acting so weird. Like, I can see him, but I can't send him anything right now. What in the world? Yeah. Okay. Anyways, that being said. Yes, this is my dream car, and oh man, who knows? One day, maybe I'll con Kevin out of it. Who knows?
That's gonna go.
We'll see how that works out for you.
Yeah, I'll see.
Yeah, but the books that I got recently, dude, I got an amazing haul recently. So, the first thing I got was this, of course, Batman Superman Volume 2 from the New 52. Which I had the first volume, which I actually really like. It's kind of weird, but. I read the first volume of this on the way to Enosh's place the first time I went there, and I needed to get the second volume, and I finally picked it up hardback or hardcover. This Batman Noir, The Black Mirror.
Oh, I didn't know they made a noir version of it.
Yeah, it's so good. I'm not a massive fan of Jock, but they have art from Francesco Francavilla, which I really like. Francavilla does a great job. And he's really good.
For those who are like who might know Francisco Francavilla, if you've readers of Archie comics will know him from like his like Afterlife with Archie, like the horror series that they do. Those sort of like old school horror covers and art. That's sort of what he does. He did a mini series for Star Wars. It was a whole bunch of horror stories around Vader's castle. It's really cool.
Dang, I'll check that out. And then I also got The Batman Who Laughs hardcover.
Okay.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. Then I got hardcover of Dark Knight's Death Metal, which I was really looking forward to reading.
I still need to read that, yeah.
Yeah, I've read Dark Knight's Metal. I've read Batman Who Laughs, but I have not read this one yet. And I got the deluxe edition, which was nice. And I got two Dark Knight Frank Miller books. One of them was The Dark Knight Returns, The Last Crusade. The other one is in my bedroom because I'm about to read it, is The Dark Knight... or Dark Knight Strikes Again, which I've been needing to read that because like I want to have all the Frank Miller Batman books. So I just need All-Star Batman and Robin and Batman Year One physical copy in order to complete the collection, which I'm very, very excited for. But I tell you what, the book that shocked me the most so far and has honestly entered like my top five in books is this, Wonder Woman Dead Earth.
Really?
I highly recommend this.
Really?
So freaking good. Like
I noticed it's a DC Black Label book.
It's Black Label and it's like such a cool story, great art. Like honestly, this makes you love Wonder Woman so much more than you already do. Like it's so freaking good.
You don't know how much I like Wonder Woman, Dawson.
Hey, doesn't matter. Doesn't matter, okay?
It doesn't matter. You don't know
funny things.
You don't know me. You don't know. Oh man, no, that's awesome!
I'm done.
I'm out of here.
Speaking of Black Label, there was like a Harley Quinn one that I keep seeing every time I go to Barnes and Noble that I've been meaning to pick up.
I keep wanting to pick up the Joker Batman Joker War Saga hardcover because I really want to read that. Mm-hmm. There's several that I have on my list that I need to get, but those are on the docket for reading as of right now. And I got most of that in one haul. Also, cool thing. I keep on talking about how there is a certain Spider-Man like storyline that I always refer to when I think of Spider-Man, which is why I love Andrew Garfield so much, is because of this specific style. And I found the books. They're illustrated by Patrick Scherberger. And it's a Marvel Adventures Spider-Man.
Scherberger.
your Shay.
So I got these little small.
Oh yeah, I remember those. Yeah,
like yeah,
a few years ago.
Yeah, these are the Spider-Man books that I grew up with. So I got copies of those, which I'm very, very stoked. I didn't know
they were digest sized.
I didn't know these were either when I ordered them, but they came this way, and I'm like, I'm not mad. But like, I had got them like monthly back for a bit when we had subscriptions to these Spider-Man comics. But these are the ones that I ended up getting back in the day. So it's cool stuff. And recommendation, TW, you know this. I did a review of it recently. Okay. Get yourself a copy of White Sand. Do it.
Nice.
Do it. Volume 1, 2, and 3, get them. They're dang good. They're impressive. If you love fantasy, get them.
Yeah. Hmm. After I get my way through my Darth Maul thing I posted on Instagram there, it's sort of I picked up Darth Maul, Son of Dathomir, you know, published by Marvel, originally published by Dark Horse Comics. It was one of the few sort of stuff that would be considered legends. It was one of the few pieces that actually got put into canon when the acquisition took over. Because it was an old unfinished Clone Wars arc. It was one of the few that was like put out there in a way after Clone Wars got canceled before they picked up season 7. Because they put a four episode arc into this 4-issue comic. It's basically what Maul was doing between you see him in season 5 and when you see him in season 7. It's what he was doing in between then.
Mm-hmm.
And they also have a novel called Dark Disciple, which is based around Quinlan Voss and the Sonic Adventures, and that's one of the other ones. And hopefully we get some more, you know, just sort of floating around or redone or maybe kind of recontextualized for Bad Batch or something.
Yeah.
Ryan Hartwell here with a $2 super chat. First of all, I have to answer a request. So this was something that I posted earlier to our Discord. That was me after putting my finger into a light socket, apparently.
I was very concerned as to where that sentence was heading.
wrong stream.
You never like know to... here. When it gets to about hour 3, all of a sudden all bets are off. But
yes, I will greet Enosh in the language of his people. Me.
Exactly. That, you see, Ben knows. That's what I said, Ben. I went outside and I told Tiffany that I look like Kid and Play in here. Like, heck yeah. Real quick, Ryan with the $2 super chat says, "What would you say is your favorite graphic novel?" For me, I got to go old school, and it's like this is just me. But it was the very first. It was the first one that I remember ever seeing, and I think it was the first that DC did of the Elseworlds labels, and that was Speeding Bullets. I thought Speeding Bullets was a fantastic story. It was really great. And if you don't know what Speeding Bullets was, Speeding Bullets was a take on what if Clark Kent had landed in Gotham and the Waynes found him.
I've heard this.
And the Waynes decided to not have any more children. So Bruce,
Bruce wasn't born. No. Kal-El is Bruce Wayne in that story.
Yes, he is Bruce Wayne. Now, but did they... Man, it's been so long since I've read that.
I know. It's been a long time.
They didn't have a second child, did they? Or did they have a second child? Okay, I didn't think so. So he's Bruce Wayne, though. You know, Kal-El is Bruce Wayne. And but then, of course, his parents die just the same. All the same vengefulness of Batman with all of the superpowers of Superman.
And him just trying to keep the thing pulled back and he's just trying to be human. And it's it's such an interesting story as a concept.
Heck yeah, it is.
I got two
on the wrong pipe.
So one of them is a Spider-Man Life Story by Chip Zdarsky. Mm. It basically tells Spider-Man's life story if like he aged naturally from the 60s all the way to like the 2010s. It's a great, fantastic story. Mm-hmm. It's really interesting. It's really compelling. Yeah, they take all Spider-Man and his rogues gallery and just age them naturally through the decades. It's really cool. The second one is
Dark 60-year-old, you know, Doc Ock.
Yeah, like he'll be like 60 or 70 in like the 2010s. It's like the end of his life. It's really cool. The other one is Dark Knight, A True Batman Story by Paul Dini, which tells it's like an autobiographical comic where it's like Paul Dini's experiences where like he gets like mugged and how that inspired him and like his love of Batman and like how he fueled that experience into Batman the Animated Series. It's really cool. Yeah.
Huh. That's cool.
That's cool.
Hey, real quick, ladies and gentlemen, this is a special treat, and I'm really happy that he could join us tonight because I've watched him. I've talked about him. I've watched him for a long time, and it's really good to have him here tonight. Welcome, That Junk Man. What's going on, man?
How's it going? Finally.
Yes. Seems
like whenever we talk about doing something, one of us is busy.
I know, man. It's so good to see you, man. So glad that you could join us tonight, man. It's an honor to have you, man. I've watched you for quite a while, watched your stuff, and I've just always loved your take, man, on Star Wars and pop culture from my era of growing up, and you know, and I love when you get to just talking about some of the things about that time, you know, and. Yeah, man. So good, man. So tell everybody a little bit about yourself. I mean, since you just popped in.
The good era of pop culture.
There you go.
The birth of pop culture. Well, if you don't know, I'm Junkman. I mean, I usually toy channel, but, you know, I cover a lot more than I talked to you a lot on Facebook. I didn't even realize it was you for a long time.
Really? Okay.
And then it hit me. I was like, wait, that's the same guy.
Yeah. And we have a mutual friend, Bruce. Everybody knows Bruce, who makes all these custom Star Wars.
His name is Bruce.
Yep. His name is Bruce. Yep. But yeah, Jenner Custom Toys. Yeah. We're all mutual friends. So yeah.
Yeah. He's in the live stream almost. We've been playing Jeopardy every night last week, and he's been in there kicking butt at it too. So, but yeah, I mean, I do pop culture. It's mostly toys. It's a lot of Star Wars, as you know. Just a lot of different, whatever I want to talk about, really. In fact, I did a video today. It was about me not making a video.
Right. What do you do when you don't have a video to make, you know? It's like.
Well, I actually did a video explaining Zuckus and Forlorn, the mix-up.
Oh, yeah.
But the whole time I'm saying I'm not going to make a video about it.
I love it. I love it. Are you other guys? You younger guys aware of that mix up?
No.
No.
Oh.
Let me just say it's not a mix up. That's what gets me.
Oh, okay. Okay. Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
I will tease my video at that.
Okay. Yeah. Well. Yeah. We don't want to give away your whole video, but yeah.
Yeah. It's not a mix up. People are like, Kenner mixed them up. No.
But I'll tease that. Basically, on the back of early Star Wars action figures, they had Forlom, as we know him today, they named him Zuckus,
right. And
they named Zuckus Forlom, and so confused, you know, everybody. Confused.
I mean, to me, it's Forlom. It's really confusing when you can tell the age of somebody by who they know who Forlom is.
Mm. Exactly. Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, back in those days, man, those early days, I remember just going to Kmart and I would just spend all my time just in that toy aisle, just looking at figures and looking at the backs of those cards and just like, oh, I need this figure and I need that figure. And oh, you know, and like, why are
when these they figures had figures out? They had figures at the store, the pegs wasn't empty.
Right. Like every time post a picture, man, of like Walmart's, man, you know, and that's how it is here. I don't get it. It's like you would think that they want to sell toys. I don't know, man. It drives
sadly, it's a dying movie action figures are a dying market.
I mean, if you've seen the new figures that came out for Falcon and Winter Soldier, I have to say they're very low quality. Like I look at them and I'm just like, I have no desire at all as a toy collector.
There's a couple of them that are okay. I mean, the Marvel Legends ones are okay. Some of the other ones I don't like.
Yeah, but it's like. A lot of the Marvel figures, I'm just like, and I like a lot of Marvel too, but like, I look at those figures, I'm just like, they just don't look appealing to me as a collector. I'm also kind of picky in my collection as well, so it might have something to do with it, but.
Yeah, I haven't seen those in person, but almost every time Hasbro does a Black Series human face, I'm like, ugh,
looks horrible.
Yeah. I was actually shocked. I stopped at a Walmart about 20 miles away from me yesterday and I wasn't even going to stop. And I walked in and, you know, I've been collecting, you know, the G.I. Joe classified, the 6-inch figures. And my favorite figure is Flint of all time. I just love Flint. I grew up, you know, in Flint, Michigan. But I just always loved him. And I have Flint and Lady J on pre-order and I've been waiting for him. And of course I walk into Walmart and they only have two G.I. Joe classified figures, which I've never, I don't think, actually walked into a Walmart and seen a G.I. Joe classified figure. And they had both Flint and Lady J. And I was like, I'm buying these. I'm not risking not getting these these figures. And so I actually bought them. And I canceled my pre-order. But yeah, man, it's just, I don't know. Having collected now for over 20 years myself, it's just, that was the fun of it, was going into stores and going from store to store. And
oh, yes. I remember the 90s were a great time, driving everywhere,
yes,
looking for stuff. And I remember me and my friend found out Shadows of the Empire was hitting stores. And it was about, we called the store and they had it on the shelf and it was about an hour away. We were like, let's go.
Heck yeah, man.
So that reminded me. Sorry, I interrupt you. Yesterday, technically yesterday where we are on the East Coast, yesterday was the 30th anniversary of the publication of Heir to the Empire.
Was it?
Man, I feel old.
Whoa.
Yeah.
Yeah. That sounds about right. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
No, 1991.
Dang.
And that was, I mean, that was a dark time between 85 and about 95. Heir to the Empire and Dark Empire was about the only thing you saw Star Wars at a store. You couldn't walk into a store. Yeah, I love Dark Empire, but it was rare. I remember driving to Media Play about an hour away because somebody told me they had a Star Wars section. I could not believe they had Star Wars at a store. So I drove up there.
Mm. Hey, H Bart's here with a $2 super chat. Says, hey, Enosh, how you doing tonight? I'm doing swell, man. I'm doing excellent. It's a Saturday night. It's a stream. We're talking old toys. We're talking cool stuff. That junk man's here. Dawson's here. RJ's here. TW's here. And we're just having a good old time. So thank you for being here, H Bart's. No, man, I know that. That's how you could like really tell who real Star Wars fans were during that time, especially because there was nothing. There were no movies, like especially like after, you know, after Return of the Jedi hit. I remember I've talked about it a couple times. So I had a friend in our neighborhood who his family was like the first family to get a VCR, and they had all kinds of like bootleg movies because they would rent movies and like, yeah, you know, tape them, you know, and so they would have all this stuff. And he had a copy of Return of the Jedi. And I was so excited about that. And we'd always go over and they had this little cabinet that they had like all their VHSs in. And, you know, we'd go over there and he'd be like, what do you want to watch today? And that's where I first watched films like Back to the Future or Nightmare on Elm Street or, you know, like all these classic 80s films. Nice. And Ferris Bueller's Day Off, you know, stuff like that. He would open it up and I'd always see Return of the Jedi there. And I'm like, dude, let's watch Return of the Jedi. And he's like, I don't want to watch Star Wars. I don't want to watch that. And I'm like, dude, you have Return of the Jedi. You can watch it anytime and you don't watch it. What is wrong with you?
Yeah. I can remember seeing, you know, right there between, I don't know y'all's age, but between 77 and the time the VHSs came out, it was like you saw any little clip of Star Wars on TV. It was like it was kid porn. Well, not kid porn like that, but you know what I mean.
Yeah. Oh, watch it. Oh, demonetized.
Uh-oh, watch it.
That junk man guy. Yeah.
Well, it was great having junk man. So that was junk man. No.
Two of you.
Because I was born during the prequel era, so I grew up mostly on like the prequel.
Likewise.
Toys, so.
No, I hear you. No, you're absolutely right, man. That was exactly what you just wanted. That's why the commercials for the toys were such a big deal, because they would sometimes show little clips and stuff from the movie and stuff. And we take it for granted so much now because we have the media at home or we can stream it or whatever. And it's all just right there at our disposal where we, you know, we literally spend hours just trying to pick something to watch now. And but back then you didn't get to see that stuff. It wasn't
those making of specials would come on and you just want to see scenes from the movie. It would just,
oh my gosh,
just could not believe it.
And that's the Saturday afternoon and that would come on. Glued. Yeah,
you forget it.
Glued. Absolutely glued.
Yeah. So the guys that grew up with the prequels, y'all don't know about that 16-year gap wait for the that was horrible. Waiting 16 years.
I couldn't imagine that. Like, it was so nuts for me to think about growing up. Like, you know, 05, Revenge of the Sith comes out. I'm like, man, waiting 3 years for the Clone Wars cartoon to start. I'm like, man, this is rough, you know?
Right. No, yeah. That's the funny thing. Like, that's kind of like an unspoken part of Star Wars history. People forget that between Jedi and Phantom Menace, there's like that big gap of content, you know, just like, yeah, this is like a dry well of stuff.
And we had some books, but
yeah, like my dad,
I'm not reading a book.
My dad prides himself on the fact that he's seen every single Star Wars movie in theaters. But like, and he talks about that time of waiting for Star Wars Episode One, and he doesn't like Episode One just because he felt like it wasn't worth the wait. But like, I'm sitting here, like, as a kid who was born in 97, you know, right before, you know, Phantom Menace came out, you know, I have grown to appreciate it more and more as time's gone on. My dad still is just like, nope, hate that one. It's like, okay.
Well, it was made for guys like us at that age, right?
Mm-hmm.
I think that's why it sort of has that a bit of nostalgic stick to it. And in my opinion, I love Revenge of the Sith. It's still my favorite prequel. But the reason Revenge of the Sith or Phantom Menace beyond a nostalgic thing has such a special place in my heart is the fact that a couple things was I love the all the tech, all the visual effects of it. In my opinion, they look the best just because it was from that sweet spot in like ILM's period when like around Jurassic Park to Phantom Menace, where they were kind of blending, you know, like sort of older school visual effects with CGI. Mm. And also I remember as a kid, because they re-aired it, I think the year after Phantom Menace came out, was they had a documentary that aired. It was about the history of ILM. And that was a really interesting thing. And I got to see, you know, that's why like I could pick out everybody and like there's Ben Burtt, there's Dennis Muir, and there's John Dykstra, you know.
Yeah.
Fincher worked on those old movies too as a matte painter, which is really cool.
Yeah,
so that's why those.
Oh, go ahead.
Go ahead. What were you saying there?
Well, honestly, I grew to love Phantom Menace just because, like, I see the world they were trying to establish that was lost in the originals. Like, they had to establish this world, this whole political system, and this whole society that was lost. And so I'm just like, okay, yes, that's cool. We get to see that, because without that, you know, the originals are like, okay, well, there's a Republic before and it's just kind of a mentioned thing. But now you get to see what that was like, how that was structured, how it worked. And I mean, despite how maybe boring it might be for some people, it's just like you see what was lost. Now you can understand.
Right. Well, I love the prequels. You know,
it's C-SPAN. It's C-SPAN for Star Wars.
I mean, literally Trade Federation politicians and figures are named after literal Republican politicians. It is literal C-SPAN, the first one, you know. But I loved seeing the Clone Wars for the first time. I mean, you know, you hear little bits and pieces of it.
See, and that's all great. But like, I I'd be interested to hear what Darren has to say about this because like, we filled that stuff in. All we would get would be little bits and pieces. You'd go to the grocery store and you'd see a magazine that would have Star Wars on it. And I remember the first time I ever read a little excerpt that talked about this fight between Obi-Wan Kenobi and Anakin Skywalker, and that there was like a volcano or something involved in lava. And you're just like, well, how in the world would he survive that? And you didn't know how it happened. You just knew that it happened. And so, you know, it was like, what were the Clone Wars? I don't know.
Yeah, and then we found out it was a cartoon. We waited 20 years to find out it was a
very,
cartoon.
A very, very good cartoon. That should have been nominated for more Emmys.
Yeah.
I think the Phantom Menace, I never hated the prequels, but I was let down with them. But it was Star Wars, so I was a little... But for now, me, looking back...
Like, yeah, 30 minutes of Phantom Menace is good. 30 minutes if it's good. Like, the final act's the best part of that movie. Everything else I can give or take, you know?
Yeah, I mean, I fell asleep during the pod race when I first saw it. I really hated the pod race.
Yeah, I'm right there with you. Like, I remember, I think I saw it in theaters, like, 8 times. And it was like, every time that I went to go see it, I was excited because it was Star Wars, but it didn't feel like Star Wars. And
yeah, I remember leaving thinking it didn't feel like Star Wars.
Yeah, I just kept thinking like every time that I went to go see it, it was somehow going to get better, you know. And even then, I remember telling myself like, okay, you know what? Maybe you're just feeling this way because you've just got such a soft spot for the original trilogy, you know, which was it. You know, that was all we had at that time, and so it was just, you know, you watched those movies so many times that you know you just got to watch this thing more and love it. H Bart's still here with a timely statement though with his $5 super chat. Growing up, he says, I found it odd people hated the prequels because I grew up loving the prequels. And I think it's like a time thing of like,
yeah, it's music, it's Saturday Night Live. You love Saturday Night Live where you grew up. when you watch Saturday Night Live, that's the best for you. Music's the best when you're in your teen years.
That I mean, the Saturday Night Live thing I have to disagree with. Back in the 70s and 80s, that's the best of SNL. Like everything from then on until now.
I'll be honest with you. I love the 90s.
90s.
Yeah, I love that 90s. Phil SNL, Hartman, Adam
with Chris Farley. Yeah, Chris Farley. But like everything it's since not, then, garbage.
Yeah.
I think it's universally agreed that modern SNL is bad, though.
Yeah, it's pretty bad.
Except for a couple of really funny sketches, which I love. But the one thing that's interesting is I think it's less about sort of what's there in your teens, but more sort of what you find in your teens. Like, I'm not really into a lot of music from, like, I was born in the mid-90s myself. So, like, it wasn't stuff from, like, sort of, I guess it would be about, what, 2010-ish. You know, that I'd probably be interested in. I'm more interested in music from the 70s and 80s and 90s than I am because I found it when I was a teenager, and that's the stuff I listen to. Like I wouldn't necessarily pick up
when you're most impressionable.
I wouldn't pick up a hard rock record from, you know, like hard rock or heavy metal record necessarily from like 2010, but you know, I have like every Judas Priest album from 75 to 90 on my phone, so
yeah.
Well, there just seems to be even, I think my son's 15 and they're just, nothing holds them anymore. There's no magic to it anymore. Everything just manufactured. The music all sounds the same. Even the movies, the Marvel movies, if you love them, within 2 weeks you forgot about them. All you do is hyped up for the next one. It just, nothing sticks around and has that staying power like it did with
the story. You're absolutely right. My son's a drummer, and when he started listening for music, there's some new music that he likes, but it's very few and far between.
Yeah, you have to dig for it.
Yeah, you really have to dig for it. You know,
it's not on the radio either. Nothing that's good is played on the radio.
No. Oh, heck no. No.
Not beyond classic rock radio, in my opinion. But,
right. Yeah, that's
a variety rock, but.
Well, thank you, Lewis. We appreciate that with your £5 super chat. Lewis from over the pond. Lewis is a good guy. And so, yeah, we're doing good, man. I love these kind of conversations, man, where we talk about stuff like this, because I think it's a snapshot into like you were talking about the birth of pop culture, you know, and how these things kind of rose to being so prevalent. Because, you know, even as a kid, what was it? Tiffany and I were just talking about the idea of like nerddom, even when we were growing up, man, like it was not cool to be a nerd. It was not cool to like nerd stuff.
No, it was. I just did a video on 10 toys that would get you beat up if you took them to school. So, yeah.
It's funny you say that, because, like, my dad grew up, of course, his dad was a football coach. So my dad was very much into football. He played football in college and everything. But I have a sneaking suspicion that my dad was a closet nerd in high school that just didn't say anything about it. Because I remember one conversation that we had with him when I was a kid. Me and my older brother were talking about, like, who's the most powerful superhero? And normal kid answer is, like, you know, Superman or something like that. And my dad, out of nowhere, we had no idea he was listening. He's like, actually, think about it. It's probably Dr. Manhattan. And we're like, who the heck is that? As a little kid, we didn't know who he was. Boy. And so, like, and now growing up, of course, reading Watchmen all the time now, I'm just like, he knew something, but he didn't delve into it like he probably should have.
Depending on how old you were, I'm kind of glad he didn't.
Well, I always felt like, you know, we were just talking about the other night, I always felt like the kid who paid attention to stuff that my other friends didn't, like, to this day, I mean, it's always been in my head, but we were just talking about the other night, the theme to the show Auto Man, like,
what?
Nah, talking about Glenn Larson, man, that was, you don't know Auto Man, TW?
No.
Oh, you're going to make me pull that out again? Like, I ended up having to show... The other night,
now I'm finding about Auto Man. Like, what
oh,
is?
Dude, you didn't
miss much. You didn't miss much.
No, there wasn't too much of it, but it was. But you know, and it wasn't that it was great. It was just that it was like a part of. I might still have the pictures here in my stuff.
It was kind of like a Tron ripoff, maybe. And that was close. Was kind of like a Tron ripoff.
Bless his heart.
It lasted maybe a season. Maybe not even a full season.
Yeah. I think it was. Yeah, it was just a few episodes. But I mean, they had a toy line planned. They did make Auto Man,
Yeah, they made an Automan figure. Yeah,
they made an Automan figure. I know I got
it. Sounds like a name for a mechanic shop. Like,
oh yeah, here it is. Here it is. Here. Yeah, they.
I mean, it looks horrible too when you see.
Oh yeah, it's bad. It's real bad. It's real bad. But you know, but the thing is though, is like I remember that show and watching that show. And look, I was just on with Robert Meyer Burnett last night on the vodka stream over on Dave Pena's show. And Robert Meyer Burnett was wearing what's that?
How's your toe, by the way?
Oh my, yeah, I broke my toe last night. I know I broke it, my pinky. I was coming down the hallway. And I was, Tiffany was doing something. We've got two right outside this door. I've got two of them because Tiffany's awesome. And she bought both of them. She bought two of them. Han Solo frozen in carbonite rugs for our long hallway here. Oh, and awesome. And so the dog decided to pee on one. And so like she's in the hallway. She's like scrubbing it up. And she's like, what are you doing? Because I was going to do a stream last night. And then Dave invited me on because Robert Meyer Burnett was on. And he's always talking about toys and pop culture and stuff. And so I was like, okay, so I'm coming down the hallway and the restroom's right there. So I was going around Tiffany. And when I did, man, my toe just caught the door frame. And just I heard it crack, dude. Heard it crack. It was so loud, like it brought me almost, like it just almost brought me down. I mean, it hurt so bad that I was laughing. That's how bad it hurt because I couldn't even.
That's
like,
how you know it's bad. You start uncontrollably laughing.
Like, just to call, like, right?
Like, oh my gosh! Like, I think I said stuff that I didn't. I said words that I don't even think I didn't even know. Like, it was just, oh my god, it hurts so bad. And like, she's just looking at me. She's like, "Are you okay?" Because she didn't realize what I did. And I'm just like, no. And then I started laughing. And I'm just like, I got to go be on a stream in like, you know, like a minute. And I'm like, oh, it hurts so bad. And so today is just like the side of my foot is all black and blue. My toe's still numb.
Is it swelling up at all?
It's well, you know what? It swelled up a little bit. It's not too bad, but it didn't swell up too bad, but it's still very sore. I had to put on some shoes earlier and that was not a fun thing. But yeah, no, here's Auto Man. Here's the action figure of Auto Man.
Oh wow.
That's Auto Man.
What is that?
It's a mocap suit.
That right there is about a 300.
Scott Bakula got stuck in the Cronenberg fly chamber. Like,
is about a $300 action figure. Is what that is?
$300.
$300. Wow.
In the immortal words of Biff Tannen, $300.
Yes, sir. Because it's rare. It's very rare.
I never saw one as a kid. Mm-mm. I would have went crazy.
No, and it's good, funny because if you look
looking at the arc, it just melt your eyes, you know.
I wouldn't turn one down though. I'll be honest with you, I wouldn't turn one down just because. I don't know. There's something about it. I liked that show growing up. It was just a picture of time. Like it was like what 83, 84 right or somewhere.
Yeah.
Right around then, and they had plans for a line of action figures. But if you look at, I don't think I have the backing of it anymore because I think I deleted them all. Yeah. But on the backer. Like it had like all the other proposed figures in the line, and all it is like three cops, like from like it's like Detective So and So, and then it's just like him in a suit, yes. You know.
But well, that's back when we could enjoy crap on TV.
Oh yeah,
it didn't have to be good. Like I used to love Jason of Star Command, and I tried to go back and watch it, and it's I was like, why did I
watch
like
Buzz Lightyear of Star Command growing up? You know,
No. I tell you, we just got this is so cool because we were having this conversation a couple nights ago with a couple people on here who are remembering all this stuff. Maybe if William gets home from work from Vegas, he'll join in this conversation because I tell you what, why I had all this stuff. I had like Auto Man stuff, and if you look down there in the bottom right hand corner, that was the guy who created Auto Man, because back then, you know, computers filled entire rooms and people didn't know what computers did exactly. Mm-hmm. And so he created Auto Man for the police department, and Auto Man had a little sidekick thing called Cursor. And it looked like the bit from Tron. And it could create anything. And so Auto Man would come out and he was glowing, you know, from his neck down. And he would, when he would need to drive somewhere, he would cursor would form like this Lamborghini that was outlined with blue lines.
This figure looks like if Luke Skywalker wore the mocap suit for the Green Lantern movie with Ryan Reynolds, and they changed the bulbs for blue ones.
Yes. Anyways, I'm gonna. I guess you missed a. I guess there's a couple of super chats that we got.
Yeah. I'll get to a second in just a second. Yeah.
Automan.
But that was the thing. Cursor could create anything though. He could create. He created a helicopter that, you know, and they always showed it at night, so it glowed, and I mean, it looked awesome. But yeah, as far but that was Desi Arnaz Jr.
Who? Oh, really?
I sent you a link. If you can click that, you will see the Halloween costume also. And the back of the car. You can see the back of the car. And the Hot Wheel car. I didn't know they did a Hot Wheel car. I would have loved that.
Where'd you send me the link?
In the private.
It's in the
in the private one. Okay. Yes.
My goodness. Yeah, it's so, like this. Also, this is how Halloween first started. You know.
Oh my goodness. Now see, I've never seen this stuff, Darren. I've never seen this. So this.
Yeah, I didn't know about the Halloween costume.
Yeah. Well, the Halloween costume is teased on the back of the card for this. Let me see.
It looks creepy. I mean, that one in the box, it just looks
horrifying. I have so many questions. Like, why make a face mask for that and not just, you know, just put the costume?
Oh my gosh, they have the auto car. I totally now.
Good course. Want... Captain Kirk, right?
Yeah, I didn't know they made that car. I need that. I got a car collection over here.
Oh, yeah, I cars, need that. You know. I need
looks
that.
Looks like the Gadget Mobile.
But that's not how. Yeah, no, you know what? It does actually, but that's not how it looked in the show. It was a Lamborghini, so it did not look that bulky in the show.
Yeah, I'm sure they do something they had already in stock and painted it.
Oh yeah. But this right here, the autocopter. Whoops, what the heck?
Yeah, it comes up a lot on that
side. I see it now because I'm on the eBay listing for the DVD set.
Okay. You can see here the...
there's a DVD. It's on DVD. I did not even know that.
If you scroll down, there's too many listings.
Okay.
Oh, my gosh.
That costume in a box, though, that just... I want that box just because it's so creepy.
Right? Oh, my gosh. But like so auto, you can see here, you can see here the... You can see the helicopter here. And I love it that this is what they gave us for the helicopter. Instead of giving us the helicopter, it's a little wristwatch thing where this little thing.
Oh my gosh!
But this I never knew that they actually made these though, because this is on the backer of the card, but I'd never seen this. Oh my gosh!
Yeah, that's the first time I think I've seen the watch in the costume.
It's so weird when you scroll down because you've got like. When you've got list of Automan for sale, it's got the Automan DVDs and Automan Hot Wheel, and then it's got a picture of Big Boss Man and Akeem, you know,
right next to it. Why did they put a facial mask? Like why did they put one for Captain Kirk?
Because they knew John Carpenter was coming. That's what happened, you know.
But you know what, man? That was how all the
yeah, you weren't going back. Yeah, you wouldn't buy a costume with no mask. That's why.
Yeah,
you had to have that rubber band that would break within the first two or three houses you went to.
Yep,
staple it back in, and
yep.
Oh my god!
A couple of things here.
I will get to these here real quick. So H Bars with a $5 super chat says, "I don't like modern day music. I prefer 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, and 90s mostly because my dad exposed me to it." And H Bards, you're absolutely right, man. That's great stuff. I mean,
that's like the sweet spot for me as well.
I'm telling you, that's when music was. I mean, just even still yet. I mean, I love that. That's my era. I mean, I love 90s. There's some you know early 2000s stuff that I like.
Yeah, it's like from a band I listen to already, I'll pick it up. You know, or even like modern stuff, but. If it's I have to go search it out, like you were saying.
Yeah. Lewis Cox had a 2-pound super chat. Yes.
I think Lewis had a super chat before that. It's like a 2-parter.
Did he? Oh.
Yeah.
Okay. Here it is. I'm sorry. So I had a 5-pound super chat. Thank you. It says, well, I'm going to say it. My favorite prequel movie is Attack of the Clones. Yeah, I know. But Yoda and Dooku fight is what I thought Yoda would look like. And then of course
that fight scene is arguably one of the funnest moments I've ever had in a movie theater when Yoda just starts jumping around fighting, like literally almost everybody in the theater that I was at as a 5-6 year old kid was just like all jumping around screaming like, yes, like it was such a fun moment. And I'm just sitting there like,
I don't think I got a chance to see that in theater. I saw Revenge of the Sith in theaters though. I was speechless for watching that movie. Just obviously, watching the 2 prequels. So I'm just sitting there like this. I think even at 11, I'm like, this is almost too much to take in. You know,
I was 6 years old and I saw Revenge of the Sith in theaters. So when Anakin Skywalker, lightsaber comes out to young, so I'm like,
I was 8 years old when I watched Revenge of the Sith in theaters. And I tell you what, it's to date still the only movie I've ever cried at in the theater.
Gosh, I was 29.
Anakin Skywalker.
I was during Rise of Skywalker when Luke pulled the X-Wing out of the ocean. I'm like, you did it.
But, I do miss that prequel era, waiting in line to see a movie and everything.
Oh, yes.
Which he's dead now. And I remember getting to the theater. I wouldn't say it's
100% dead. I mean, for Endgame, the line was out the door. Same with the Force.
Yeah, but isn't it most people with already tickets?
Yeah. That's.
Yeah, I guess so. Yeah.
That's a very good point.
You can't bring lightsabers anymore. You can't dress up.
What?
Really? At least around here, they don't want you to bring.
That must have changed recently because I went to the 10 p.m. screening of Force Awakens at my local theater and they had that. So.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, they didn't do. Did they do even midnight showings? That's at least around here. It died out.
They stopped doing midnight showings. Now they're like 9 p.m. showings.
Yeah, they had like here up here local to me in Canada. They had like 7 a.m. like a 7 p.m. and a 10 p.m. 7 was I still can't believe they air them that early, but it happened.
Yeah, I think we do 7 now. Yeah, around here.
Yeah, we I don't know. I agree. I remember waiting in line when I got tickets for me and all my friends for episode 1.
Oh,
okay. I went because I had the day off, and so I went and got the tickets, and I waited, and
so you're like foreman with the sticks tickets
because there was no pre-ordering tickets back then.
No,
I remember people in tents for months being outside my theater.
Yep. We waited until they opened, man, and then I finally was able to go, and I had to get money from everybody and make sure that I had the cash to go actually buy all those tickets, and then trying to make sure that everybody who was like, oh yeah, I can't see you before then, but just give me a ticket, are you sure? Yep. And then it's like you would always inevitably end up with somebody who
was like, you didn't have to go
I can't make it.
And there was no assigned seats, so you had to make sure
that's the
you wanted the middle seat. So.
That's why I understand especially lining up, because even forgetting, because you could probably still, like Enosh did, pre-order tickets, but we all have IMAX now where we all have assigned seats, and so lining up is kind of, it is almost been rendered obsolete as a concept to me, which is kind of crazy to think about.
I love assigned seating though, because otherwise it's
I mean, it's useful. Good and bad.
It's useful, but you do lose that little bit of that camaraderie experience, especially if you go to cons, right? Where, if you're going to cons, it's still, you get that chance to talk to people in line and, you might make a friend or something like that.
Hold on just a second, man. Yeah. Holy cow. Holy cow. Supercam 1721 with a $49.99 super chat. Dude, thank you, bro. Thank you. It says, I'm back. Yes, you are. Thank you. You came back in a big way. I'm seeing colors that I don't think I've seen in a while. Pink. Wow, that's amazing. says, I respect that Jarbo is your friend. Jarbo who? No.
I think he means Jat Marbo.
Jat Marbo, yes, Jat Marbo, not Matt Jarbo. I respect that Jarbo is your friend, he says, but he needs to stop with the Wint with the BS about Snyderverse. This is what WB wants to divide us. We need to stay positive and think positive. We need Fiona back, but she hasn't been on Twitter since March 18th. So I'll say this, Super Camp. So, Matt and I, we have differing opinions on the Snyderverse and whether or not it's dead or not, whether or not it can still exist, whatnot. So look, some people, they go with the information that they have. Matt is a very analytical kind of guy. And when he doesn't see, something, but of course Matt is old school too. So Matt, I think sometimes has that old, and I would say this if he was here, I just said it to him the other night when he was here, we had this whole conversation right here. So,
So the thing is Matt, you know, sometimes I think he looks at things in a very certain, you know, straight up way. I mean, he's said several times this week, oh, it's done. It's done. And then something else happened. Oh, it's done. Nope. It's done now. Okay. You know, so I joke with him about that. I tease him about that. But you know what? The thing about that is sometimes there's things that you don't know. And there are paths to the Snyderverse continuing, and some things that I think that maybe some people haven't even thought of in the ways that it could continue, and we could actually get those stories of what might happen in Justice League 2 and 3. So, and we're going to talk a little bit later about, you know, the new pictures that that Zack dropped. You know, as far as Fiona, like, I'll be honest with you, like, you know, I don't know too much about Fiona. I know that she, you know, helped start the movement. You know, that she, you know, she got help get things out there, you know, and was very much a part of it. You know, I would love to see Fiona get back more involved in, you know, in this kind of groundwork stuff. You know, I think a lot of people have kind of taken up the mantle and moved on to try to make things great. But yeah, I mean, we haven't heard from her in a long time. And I mean, even since before March 18th, we haven't heard from her that much this last year. So I would love for her to get back, because I know a lot of people look at her and hold her in high esteem as far as in the movement of the Snyder Cut and stuff. And so I would absolutely love to see her and others really just kind of, you know, come back up and, you know, and just really push to support things, you know. And so I guess, you know, I guess we'll see what happens, you know. In any case, there's always going to be winners and losers. And so for that, this is for you, man.
There's two types of people in this world. There's winners and there's losers. And just so that we're clear, every time we step on this field, our goal is to be a winner. And if your dad has said, oh, it doesn't matter whether you win or lose, just as long as you have fun, well, I hate to say it, your dad's a loser.
And maybe Matt Jarbo. I don't know. If Matt Jarbo says we're all done, I don't know. Real quick, too. H. Bartz with a $10 super chat. Thank you, man. Says, even though I grew up with the prequels, the first Star Wars film I saw in theaters was The Force Awakens. Oh, wow. Also, Lego Star Wars got me into Star Wars as a whole.
Lego Star Wars, that did the same thing for me too, actually. Helped reaffirm my love.
Lego Star Wars is the GOAT.
I love that. This voice out of nowhere.
Lego Star Wars is the best Lego game that has ever been made, and no one can change my mind.
I can't wait for the new one. They're doing Lego Star Wars, the Skywalker saga. I can't wait for that.
Yeah, that looks good. I'll probably wind up picking that one up.
The complete saga one, though, like, nothing can replace that. Nothing.
It's classic, yeah.
Did you guys watch the Lego Star Wars holiday special?
No.
Yes, I did, actually. I did.
Yes, I did.
I watched that, yeah.
It's actually really good, Dawson. Give it a shot next Christmas. It's really fun. Trust me. It's written by, like, Traveler's Tales, the guys who do the Lego Star Wars stuff. So it's really funny. It's like post-episode 9. So like
I'm curious to hear if you guys have known about this. Speaking of Traveler's Tales, Traveler's Tales has made some really good games, of course, outside of Lego. One that they made that I really love, even though it's infamous for its ending, is Haven Call of the King. You guys ever played that?
No.
It was a PlayStation 2 game. It was a action-adventure game where basically it combined elements of like being a normal explorer, attack enemies and stuff, but also like vehicle segments and turret segments. Like on the PlayStation 2, it was very much ahead of its time in trying to explore different types of gameplay in one game. But like the ending is just, they were expecting to make sequels, and boy, do they leave a cliffhanger of all cliffhangers, and they never got a sequel. So it's like, dang it.
So, you know what? I'll say this about this. You know what I love about this comment is the fact that it doesn't matter when you got into Star Wars. Star Wars is one of those things that I love. I love now that I have three boys who are 15.
Star Wars gets into
16,
you.
16. Yeah, right. 15, 16, and 18. And when I see my boys excited about something that I was excited about as a kid, like that's why, you know, and I know Darren knows where I'm coming from with this, because we joke about some of those same people nowadays who just want to hate on
every Star Wars thing that, you know, that comes up and everything, you know, is that, look, it's just Star Wars. And it, I don't care when somebody got into Star Wars. I don't care if somebody's favorite movie is the, you know, the Phantom Menace or, you know, Lego Star Wars or whatever. It's like, it's just Star Wars, man. And that's just, it's lightsabers and Jedis and, you know, and like Ryan here, you know, like even Ryan super chat, it's sand, it's coarse, it's irritating, it gets everywhere, it doesn't matter, like, you know, it's just enjoying it as a property. Yes.
Well, that's why I went to see Solo and I liked it, but everybody bashes on it. And I said, well, one reason I liked it, I took my son and his friends to see it, and they were jumping up and down loving it. And I said, yeah, that just seeing them react to it made me love Solo. I'll never hate Solo, like, you know,
Solo was such a victim, a poor victim of circumstance. Like, if it weren't for the fan backlash of Last Jedi, then Solo would be a commended insert into the Star Wars franchise, because to me it felt like the most Star Wars or most A New Hope-esque since A New Hope, honestly.
I like it. I think the release date hurt it too. I think it was a lot of things, not just.
Yeah.
It came out on like what, the 25th or something like that? Like,
even advertised until the Super Bowl, like 3 months before a trailer even came. They should have had a trailer with The Last Jedi.
Right.
It didn't make any sense. That would have been what, 2017? 6 months after. I think that there was a lot of things that hurt it. It was a couple of things. Was one, it was 6 months after The Last Jedi, right? So it was 6 months after the last Star Wars movie. So there was never this like hype train for, oh, we're getting another Star Wars movie, right? It was kind of like, hey, let's hurry up and get that one in there. Plus, it just hurt from the fact that I think that also, I'll be the first one to say, like, I wasn't asking for a young Han Solo movie. Mm-hmm. I didn't realize I was going to enjoy it that much until I saw it. And then it was like, oh, yeah, no, this is cool. I like this. I like this a lot. And then, look, Harrison Ford, you know, We all loved Harrison Ford, and the idea of him being replaced rubbed people the wrong way. And then you mix that with the mixed reactions to The Last Jedi. It was almost like this perfect storm. And then people knew that, you know, the story of what had happened with Lord Miller, you know, being almost done with it. You know, what's his name coming in and finishing it. It just seemed like there was so many things about it that people just didn't get hyped for it. And like you said, Darren, like, it just didn't have the
Star Wars is not Marvel. It needs hype.
Yes.
Yeah.
I have a question particularly for you, Enosh, and Darren. Is you guys were around for like around the marketing and so forth, and probably I'm imagining at least had some interaction online with some of the, you know, stuff with the prequels, like around the time the prequels came out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So my question is, was there something comparable with the casting of Ewan McGregor as Obi-Wan as there was with Alden Ehrenreich as Han? Like, was there a similar opinion about like recasting and things like that?
There was never really any. I think because it was such, I mean, we just saw Harrison Ford was so iconic to that role, and everyone knew the prequels would have to recast Obi-Wan.
That's true.
So I think going in, we knew, and it was so 20 years before. So I think we really,
I mean, the original actor for Obi-Wan was dead.
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, everybody knew since, you know, the early days that there would be a story of a young Obi-Wan and we would have someone else cast. I don't remember any doubt. He wasn't that really well known. Well, I guess the guy that played Solo wasn't either. I mean, he had train spotting in some other movies, but there was never, I don't remember any really shocking upset.
I think it was just like train spotting at that point for Ewan.
Had he done Big Fish at that point?
No.
Big Fish was 2001, I think.
Was it?
No.
Okay, so it was right after that. Okay. I couldn't remember
when. Or 2005, I think it was, actually.
Because I actually really enjoyed that movie. That's a good
I saw
movie.
Bits. Like, it looks really interesting.
I didn't think I was going to like that movie, and we rented it once, and I was like, oh. Like, I rented Oz it when
direct,
it came out.
Did Frank Oz direct that movie?
Did he?
Am I thinking of something else?
An Ewan McGregor movie I really want to see is Moulin Rouge with Nicole Kidman. I love the music from that soundtrack, but I haven't seen the movie. But
I've seen clips again with Moulin Rouge. And I think that what was funny about everyone started pointing out after Clone Wars started was have you seen Clone Wars? Everyone here seen Clone Wars, or at least parts of it?
Yeah.
Oh, yo, yeah. Yeah, yeah. Right, I'm looking at something here.
You know what the name of animation? Yeah, you know what the name of the Star Wars The Clone Wars, the CG.
Oh, the good one.
Yeah.
The first one.
No, because the 3D one, the newer one. But like I'm saying, if you guys have seen it, the reason I was referencing it, you want to know what's funny? The name of Ewan McGregor's, like Nicole Kidman's character, who's his love interest in that movie, her character's name is Satine.
Really?
Yes, which is, of course, Clone Wars fans are familiar with another character named Satine, you know? So it was a very interesting coincidence.
Maybe this is a hot take, but I actually enjoy the Genndy Tartakovsky 2D animated.
That's not Clone a hot Wars. Take. I too.
It's not a hot take at all. I don't like the Clone Wars. I do like that first one.
Like, I love the way they portray Grievous in that cartoon. They make him really scary.
Grievous was great. I thought it was interesting how they actually explained how he wound up with the smoker's cough.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, you know, yeah. But
I did like Grievous in the CG Clone Wars, the Filoni Lucas Clone Wars.
By the way, I want to say a shout out to all of our mods. I want to thank you for the job that you're doing. We haven't had issues with people in a while, and so I'm very, very thankful. I was curious because I was seeing stuff, and it doesn't show when something gets redacted in my stream. Oh. So I want to everybody thank your mods. Thank you to you guys. You guys are doing a great job. It's so funny. People get so buttered.
Yes. Shout out to the mods who actually do stuff. I may have mod status, but I don't do stuff.
Well, you need to start earning your keep, buddy.
I do. I've kind of joked that, like, you know, you should kind of rescind my mod status. If only the reason I like having it is I'm like, oh, good. It kind of puts my comments that, you know, kind of prioritizes my chat comments. I'm like, all right, does maybe it? I should keep it.
No, so it's selfish reasons.
Oh no, I love the
no response.
I know. I agree. No I comment. Agree. Like, look, when we were getting ready to go into the prequels, I think everybody was just so excited that there was a Star Wars movie coming out that we weren't griping about all these little things about, you know, this we didn't like or that we didn't like. You know, it was just, there was such an energy. I mean, I had a subscription to Star Wars Insider magazine, and every month when that magazine would come out, and I just looked through it and looked through the pictures, and it was like Darth Maul looked so intimidating and so just evil. And it was just like, whoa, what are we getting here? And, you know, I don't think anybody was complaining about, you know, Ewan McGregor or anything like that, you know, like what you got to do. Cause we realized it was something that was going back 30 years, you know, whatever, we're going to have to be told that story. And
I remember being online, you know, on chat rooms and message boards and everything back then. And most people was disappointed or didn't love it. I don't remember any anger and hate if somebody did like it. I don't remember people upset about the actors or Lucas. I think some people was upset with, you know, they wrote songs about Lucas and stuff, but I don't remember all this, you know, behind the scenes drama and stuff that I really can't stand with a lot of talk of the new Star Wars stuff.
I think it kind of helps also, especially a lot of that was very decentralized too. Like, you have dedicated message boards here and there you might go to, right. But everyone goes to YouTube. Everyone goes to Twitter.
Everybody's got a channel.
And I know. I know it.
Social media platform, too. So everyone's in the same spot. So everyone's looking at the same thing, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. What were you saying, Darren? Yeah.
So I know doing videos. Those upset videos do get a lot more. I mean, I can. If you want to grow your channel. Just go along with everybody else.
Yeah. Oh, for sure.
Drama clicks.
Oh, for sure. I love this. I had this planned. I just like saved this earlier today, before we were having this conversation. But it's fitting because just as Star Wars fans, Luke, there's this Disney ruined Star Wars. Really? No, you ruined Star Wars. No, that's not true. That's impossible. Attacking George Lucas after the prequels, bullying actors off social media, insulting people who like the new episodes, constantly blaming others for why you don't feel the same way you did as a child. Search your feelings. You know it to be true. No.
Actually, no, I was curious. We were in the chat. We're talking about this. Do you guys like Star Wars Rebels? Because I love Rebels.
I like Rebels. I've seen about half of it. I'm obviously familiar with the ending, but like what I've seen so far, I like.
I love the cast. I love Sabine. I love Hera. I like
the cast and characters. My only gripe with the Clone Wars. The lightsabers are too freaking pointy. They're like rapiers instead of lightsabers.
Oh, for Rebels, you mean Rebels?
Well,
Rebels?
That was kind of designed.
Yeah, Clone Wars.
It was a more civilized time where the lightsabers were skinny.
They were needles.
The reason why it looked like that.
Ralph McQuarrie.
Yeah, was because entire show was based on Ralph McQuarrie's concept art. If you look at, you know, the original, like that iconic.
Doesn't fix it for me.
Well, it's all right. You know, you have everyone's entitled to their opinion, even if their opinion.
And mine's right.
Yes. Yeah, you like the Broncos. None of your opinions are right.
I can't get into Rebels or Clone Wars. It just looks awful.
Really? See, you know what? So Rebels starts off really slow, but once Rebels kicks in, like it's probably some of the best like deep dive into the Force and like the lore. That I think I've ever seen, like, because I didn't think I was gonna like Rebels at first, and after I got into like you get start getting into the second season, I was about ready to drop it. I'll be honest with you, like after the first half of the first season, I was like,
yeah, that's about
it's the second season where that show finds its groove, though.
Yes,
when you see the season finale of season one, and like you just hear the breathing, and you're like, oh my goodness, things about to get real, you know.
And although I don't like them too, I don't get on YouTube and bitch about it. I just know they're not made for me. They're just not made for me, so I just don't like them.
You kind of say your piece, wash your hands of it.
If there was more people like Druckmann in the Star Wars fandom, it'd be a lot more welcoming and friendly place.
Oh, that's going to get clipped. That's going to get clipped. Somebody's going to clip.
Well, Earth 2, like, and you don't have Earth 2 me making like 12 videos of it a day.
Well, I'm just saying, like, you literally just said, you know, if it's not for me, I'm not going to complain about it, so we need more of.
But he trolls like crazy on Twitter, though. So
yes, I do.
You troll like crazy on Twitter. I can't tell if you're full of it or not sometimes. It's maddening.
It's fun. It is fun to say.
Matt Jarbo. Let Matt Jarbo know.
people say that Matt's a troll on Twitter.
No. Hold on here. I'm a factual shit poster. There's a difference. So there's a massive difference there. Like Junkman, if you ever read his tweets, he'll like say things that you're like, okay, right.
I'll say Ray is the best Skywalker of them all.
Yeah, and you do. Yeah, and you do that to get certain responses out of certain people in pool houses. They fall for it every time. I've seen for.
Hey, you guys! Anyway, no.
Just walk into that. That means right. I mean they're here tonight. You know, even you know. Yes, it's the Junkman. Oh my God!
He's a Raylo.
How dare you?
You know, how dare you,
Junkman? How dare you?
Have you ever met a Raylo? Because I hear people complain about him all the time, but I never run into him. One time I did a poll that said something about Raylo, and they came into my – I never run into him. And they stay in their own corner. They don't bother anybody.
They do their own thing unless they're, you know.
Yeah.
I did a poll one time, and I got a bunch of them at me. But.
Oh, my God. No, I'm with you, man. I don't know anybody who's beaten down anybody's doors to.
No, they're over there on Tumblr doing their thing.
Tumblr even still around?
It is just all the NSFW stuff got nuked off at about what was it, like 5 years ago?
Yeah, but the thing is now Tumblr's owned by WordPress, and I'm actually really interested to see where that goes.
That sounds real interesting.
Yeah, because the platform, Tumblr as a platform, is actually really good.
It seems like a solid thing. If you're doing full-on WordPress integration, that seems like you could do something with that.
Yeah. I mean, and they bought it for a steal. They bought it literally for it, like pennies on the dollar. Like, you know, it was Yahoo is so toast now as a result of all the dumbness.
Let me read a couple of these real quick. Lewis Cox with a 5-pound super chat says, okay, I say this. I don't care who shot first. It doesn't change my love of Star Wars. Well, because we all just know that Han shot. Like... We're actually going to do a watch party.
There's a sequel trilogy about that, actually.
We're actually going to do a watch party.
And it ended terribly.
We're going to do a watch party.
Should have pulled out.
We're going to do a watch party the week after May the 4th, hopefully, that weekend, where we show the original trilogy in its original form. So no special editions, no nothing like that. We're gonna do a watch party over on Twitch, and so we'll leave a video open here on YouTube where people can follow us over there. And I think we're just gonna I'm gonna try to rig it up where it can show just one after the other, because we can do that on Twitch. And so because I've got a copy of the original three, and we're gonna watch them the way that they were, with Han just shooting Greedo in cold blood and walking away and paying the guy, flipping him the coin, and saying, "I'm sorry about the damage there." You know,
that was my favorite scene in Star Wars. That's why it bugs me so much. But Lucas did. Mm-hmm. It makes no sense why he even did it.
Yeah, but see, the worst sin is that it influenced Spielberg to replace all the guns in E.T. with walkie talkies.
Yes.
Didn't Spielberg go back though and said,
he admitted that was a bad idea. He admitted that was a bad idea. Good for him.
No, exactly. I love the robot chicken scene, where they do that, where they talk about the special edition of E.T. and it's like it shows them all like holding walkie talkies, like shotguns and stuff. That's awesome. H. Barts with another $5 super chat says, "This may seem odd, but I love the prequels a lot more than the originals, and I'm not hating. I love the original trilogy." And that's what I was saying, man. You know, it's like, it's
I'm guessing he grew up with them.
Probably. I don't know how old H. Barts is, but
I think he did mention he did grow up with the prequels.
Yeah. I think he did, yeah.
Everybody's favorite is, or everybody's least favorite is somebody else's favorite, right?
Yeah.
But you,
that old gold man adage, right?
You mentioned E.T. and Robot Chicken. There's also another one where E.T. finally gets home, and it turns out E.T.'s like kind of special compared to the other versions of him.
Yeah.
Freaking Kleebar made his way back to the planet. I thought he left him on Earth. It's freaking Kleebar. What are you doing?
Yeah.
Blow all our fingers.
Heck yeah. Well, hey, you know, I keep him right here. You know, have you ever done the study?
The name.
Kleebar, I know. Which is interesting though, because if you ever do the study of, like, you know, because E.T.'s race, the Brodo-Asogians, is in Star Wars. It's in episode one.
They have a little cameo.
And so of course they don't just throw anything in there. Yeah, they don't just throw anything in there. Now they got to be canon. And it's interesting because they actually talk about, they've never connected it directly, but they talk about how that there was a, like an expedition of Brodo-Asogians who went out to find another galaxy. And like went on this quest, and they were on their ship, and they went off into deep space, and it was approved by the Senate and all this stuff. And they went and did their thing, man.
That's so cool.
Oh, yeah.
And if you notice in E.T., he does notice Yoda when he walks past him.
Right?
He does, right. Like he knows who he is.
Home. So,
yeah.
Just saying. Like, I actually did that when I was first on YouTube. I did this little thing called I Want to Know, where I would have people ask me questions. And then people would ask me the stupidest stuff ever. Like, you know, people would ask me stuff like, okay, well, apples and bananas. And I'm like, so not even apples and oranges. You know, it was oranges and bananas. And it was just like, oranges and bananas what? So I had to basically fill in all of the whatever. And so I did this whole video about oranges and bananas and, like, you know, the benefits of both. And I actually learned a lot. I discovered that the banana that we have today is not the banana that we had 100 years ago. That banana is extinct. All the banana flavoring that is today, that's why banana flavoring doesn't taste like bananas, is because it's based on the taste of bananas like 100 years ago instead of bananas today.
My mind is just
blown. But I do have to ask you this.
And apparently the bananas we have today are in danger of being extinct as well, because they're constantly having to re-genetically alter bananas.
Yeah, so my question for you is real simple. What's Orange, that? You glad people stopped asking you stupid questions?
From Auto Man to bananas. This has got to be the most oddest live stream I've ever been on.
Oh, but I'm going live at 11, so if you want weird.
Oh, okay.
That's true. But no, I say that though because somebody asked me, they said, how far is a galaxy far, far away? And I actually used that story of of how that is, because apparently there's a story about like a pocket galaxy that they just discovered not too long ago, that's like so many hundred thousand, you know, light years away. And like, I did this math, like my head hurt when I was done doing that one. But like, I just put all this, these little facts together. And I was like, well, wait a second. But we also know that, that ET's race was a part of that. And so, and it's like, so in space travel, you actually have to consider that when figuring out how close would they have to be, you know, the closest they could possibly be. Ryan, I always love Ryan with a final super chat here. It says that there's a scientific study that explains why modern music sounds awful. And here it is. So sometimes it just is. It just is.
Yeah.
I guess I'm passing this information off to you, Drunk or
why do I owe him $5? Why do I owe Junk3PO $5? I think I've gave him more live stream chats than ever. I don't think, right? I've ever seen him. Yeah. So.
Right? You know what you should do, man? You should do a thing like I did, like with Mike Zero when I created my Mark Uno character. You should make Junk 3PO.
There you go. I already got the fake Doomcock videos I do. So
yeah.
I might have to think about that. Maybe I need a Drunk 3PO puppet. If I can find a
puppet. H-Bars with the $10 super chat says, Passion of the Jarbo is here. They said the age of Jarbo would never come again. It has to. We live in a society where Jarbo is a distant memory. Isn't that right, Uber Eats? That right there, H-Bars, has got to be one of the greatest super chats you have ever set in. And the fact that Matt was here for it is just absolutely fabulous. That's awesome.
Yeah. H-Bars said, you know what? Now is the time to take the one.
Yes. Yes. And then Lewis Cox with the 5-pound super chat says, I love Star Wars Rebels, and who put me in timeout? I don't know.
It was an accident. Yeah. Barcy's phone glitched while we were handling mods. Oh,
okay.
So. Yeah, we're squared away. Right.
It's yeah. Yeah. Lewis is one of the good ones. But yeah, man, I tell you what, I just love Star Wars, you know. I just love
what?
I know I get so tired of everybody just griping and complaining about that stuff, and you know, and it's like just move on, just love the stuff that you love, don't like the stuff that you don't like, have fun with it all, and you know, and let, if people want to be a Reylo, let them be a Reylo. What is it going to hurt you? You know, like, I don't know. You know, I don't care.
Some people go to Reylo for their
thing with that, though,
Amazon if guy, you, but you know,
I don't want to promote the term bring back bullying, but if you just let everyone,
that's never a good place to start off.
That's a horrible, that's like your sentence, man.
We need that hashtag.
I'm kidding. But it's like, but the thing is though, if they go unchecked, that's where they go to Tumblr. And that's why Tumblr is terrible, because you find like Reylo slash fic, you know, and it's like some, you know, like 48-year-old unmarried spinster cat lady who's writing her dream fiction about Kylo just mounting her like a Christmas turkey.
Do you have her email address? Sounds like my kind of woman.
Yeah. Hold on. I think she's.
Maybe I should get on Tumblr. Maybe I should.
You're missing out.
That's the best response to that I think you're going to ever be.
Tumblr, you barely know her.
Oh, my gosh. That is hilarious. Oh,
Lord.
That is excellent. All right.
And with that, I think that's my cue to head out.
Oh, my gosh. That's got to be.
Have yourselves a good night, everybody. I am
all right, DW.
It was good seeing you. Nice meeting you. Nice meeting you, Darren. I will definitely, if I'm not subbed to your stuff, I will be by the end of the night.
Excellent.
Thanks. Excellent. And I got to dip out too, actually. It's getting a little late on my end. I got to get up in the morning.
All right. Yeah. We all got to get up in the morning. But yeah, I wanted to talk about this. We got on this amazing discussion about Star Wars and stuff. I wanted to talk about these awesome pictures that we saw. We'll still talk about them, but
I won't be able to help you any. But
this Wayne T. Carr thing. Do you got just a minute, Dawson? Because I know you're excited about this, and I know it's probably one of the things that drew you into the conversation. Do you got just a minute that you can give me, like 5-10 minutes?
Sure.
All right. We'll do this, because who knows what we'll end up getting back to. But real quick. Yeah, so we got these. Let me find
John
the pictures.
John Stewart.
Again. Yep. So the whole John Stewart thing, man. Like, and I had to make this this thumbnail because somebody told me I'm just like living in my own little echo chamber because I don't have anybody on Matt Jarbo who has a differing opinion than mine.
Oh, I have many differing opinions.
I know
that people today have told me that. that they don't like. It's funny.
Well, that's why people need to leave me alone about it, because like I have other people who don't necessarily agree with me on stuff. It's fine. But no, this, I thought that this was a cool thing today because Zack had talked about that they shot so many scenes. I mean, like all the extra stuff that was in the Snyder Cut was all shot in his driveway, and to actually see the picture of it, it's so cool.
Yeah, he shot Martian Manhunter that way. He shot John Stewart that way. Like, man, it's insane.
Look at that.
And at least from some of the closer pics, it looked like he was like in the scene. He was like putting on his Green Lantern ring and suiting up. Which, if that was the case, it would have been really cool to see.
Oh my gosh, just that's just a cool little, I love it. Driveway Productions. It just reminds me of like, especially those of us who are content creators, like this, like the stuff that the places we set up and shoot and, you know, and do funny things. Speaking of that oranges and bananas video, I set up in the back of, we have, I don't know where you guys are, but we have a store around here called Meyer. And it's basically like a higher end Walmart is basically what it is. You know, it's groceries, it's everything. And I was in the back part of it, like back by their shipping place, because they had this really cool wooden setup. And so like I actually filmed that back there, and they came back there and threatened to call the cops on me. So, you know,
hey, I mean,
now I'm looking at the picture, and all I can think about is I want that green screen,
right?
Yeah,
yes, but I love it because it's just draped, man. I just, that's yeah, so mine, cool.
Mine on the wall, like this, and I have man, to move everything.
He shot those good looking scenes of Martian Manhunter and look how good they looked in the movie. All that was done in his driveway. So, hey, maybe they can just film the next Justice League movie in his driveway.
Well, I said, man,
green screens.
Fan film it up, man. Fan film it up. But that's just when somebody like Zack Snyder is doing that. That's just cool to me. I just think that's a cool thing to show that, you know what, anybody can do it. And then look at this, right here, the close up of him. You know, obviously he didn't make it into the movie, which is a shame. But you know, he was,
I hope they release this in some way. Maybe like as like a deleted scene on like the Blu-ray when that comes out.
I would imagine that Zack would post the still of the shot before he posts the scene, because he did mention on Vero that he has an awesome still of it, or a couple of awesome stills. So I'd imagine he put them as photos.
So the funny thing is, I had heard that this was coming, and I was surprised at like how quickly from the time that I heard that this was coming to the time that it actually got released, that it came. But look, he's obviously looking at somebody there. They got a tennis ball up there for him to be interacting with. Their tennis ball on a stick. Mm. You know?
Wouldn't that really be Ben Affleck?
Well, apparently the idea, there was people talking about the fact that it would be John Stewart and Kilowog coming to Ben Affleck.
Yeah.
So maybe he'd be like looking to the side to speak to Kilowog, or maybe motion to him, saying like, we're here to help or whatever. Something like that, I'd imagine. Unless, of course, it's just a very low angle, and that's just supposed to be, you know, 6'4" Ben Affleck.
Well, you know, it's probably the Kilowog is next to him, and you know, and he's actually interacting with Ben. Because if you watch the Snyder Cut, you know, Martian Manhunter comes down and has a conversation with him and stuff. You know, well, they're probably floating in the air here, wouldn't they be? Like, because would they still be floating? Because I mean, Ben Affleck is looking up. I don't know. That's a lot of nerd stuff. A lot of nerd stuff to think about. Because at the end of the, he lands. I'm sorry. That's
yeah,
right.
Yeah, Martian Manhunter lands.
Yeah, he lands. So yeah, so they probably just came, landed, and had that conversation. And, you know, but it sucks though that like Warner Brothers even interfered with that. Mm-hmm. You know, because they got that Green Lantern show coming out, and you know,
which clearly shows they don't get how the multiverse works, or they're just simply out of spite.
Right. That's the thing that blew me away. It's like, okay, you're not going to have John Stewart in the scene because we're doing a Green Lantern show on HBO Max, which John Stewart apparently is not even in, by the way. It's Guy Gardner, Jessica Cruz, and Simon Barrett, and Alan Scott.
Well, so they, like, they've said that. They've
what's
said,
going on?
They've said, actually, that it's going to take place over a few different decades because it will have Alan Scott in it from way back in the day, the original Green Lantern, and it's going to take place actually over time, so we just never know who's going to show up in the show. So, you know, John Stewart could show up still.
But even if he does, why can't there be two?
Right. If you can put Michael Keaton and Ben Affleck in the same movie, both as Batman, why can't you have a version of John Stewart in this movie? Like, what are these rules? I don't understand these rules. Like,
they all don't of a sudden, understand it's simply the rules.
Spite. It's like it's a multiverse, but yet you can't do this because it'll add confusion. Well, you're putting two Batman in the same movie, like, and maybe more while you have another Batman in production. So
yeah.
So what are these rules? I don't understand these rules. Apparently, these rules only apply to Zack.
It kind of seems like my theory on the multiverse in live action is coming true.
Well, no, you know what? Look, my thing is this. No, because your thing is you just don't like it.
I have said that I don't like it from a story-based perspective and how it's going to impact the average viewer, like let's say in Oklahoma, who doesn't read the comics or know everything. That's what I'm talking about. And if the rules just in this very simple scenario are already convoluted to us, the average viewer, who are, well, I wouldn't say average, we know more than the average viewer, then how do you think they're going to take it?
But see, that's the thing is it's not confusing though because of it just being the multiverse, Matt. It's confusing because
the studio is butchering it.
Because the studio is messing it up.
Do you not think they're going to continue on this path? I mean, it's pretty.
Well, there was an interesting article on Screen Rant where they talked about how at first the whole multiverse thing seemed like a great idea, but now the title of the article literally says Warner Brothers is using the multiverse as a cheap plot device. This is essentially, which is what I'm starting to see now with all the spitefulness they're using with the whole, you know, John Stewart Green Lantern thing and everything else they're doing with just all the stupidity that's been going on there, is that it does simply just look like they're using it as a cheap plot device to try to just weasel their way to just do whatever the heck they want and not care about
right. Whole narrative. I mentioned this to Jarbo as well. It feels like DC's using the multiverse for a business reason, not a creative storytelling reason. It's them trying to get away from just doing standalone stories and not connecting certain movies.
It's because they've got so many irons in the fire and they don't know how to put them out, or they don't know how to combine them. And so what they're doing is they're throwing everything at the wall to see what might stick, when nothing is going to stick because it's going to just be confusing. You know, because here's the thing. Titans and Doom Patrol apparently both exist in the same universe, but they're just two separate universes.
See, that's...
And now apparently that
blew my mind.
Now apparently the Stargirl show now apparently takes place in the same world as the Batman movie with Robert Pattinson, Earth 2 or whatever. And it's just that was stated somewhere.
That doesn't even make any sense because on the Flash they established that Earth 2 also is the world where they first went to, where a bunch of other stuff happened. So it's like,
it's showing Warner Brothers can't
the same place as the Titans showing.
Like
that.
Warner Brothers can't get their story
straight. I know. We sound right now like the all the adults on Charlie Brown right now is like wah 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 wah. But yeah, so I get it. It's complicated.
I'm trying to figure out why Jon Stewart from The Daily Show is in a DC movie.
But look how good his figure looks though. Like, you know what I mean? Like you look at that. I mean, and then you look at him. He would have been awesome.
Yeah.
Has anyone ever seen him act?
I have not.
So how do you know it'd be awesome?
Well, because he looks good.
This is why people like me matter.
Here's why. Okay, look, I'm just saying he looks awesome because he looks like the role. And here's the thing. Zack has not. I don't think that Zack would have taken a chance on putting him into the Snyder cut
if he was bad.
Well, he also took a shot at the moon. How he would have had one, two lines, really? I mean, you know, we don't know what show us the audition tape of him as Green Lantern, then we can decide.
I'm gonna take a guess from someone that don't know that much. It's Kathleen Kennedy's fault.
Yeah,
somehow, some way.
Nice job. Wow.
H Parts with a $2 super chat says tennis ball Affleck confirmed. That's in the multiverse, he's a tennis ball. He's just
It's actually really funny because in the end of Armageddon, when Affleck was doing the scene where he's on the elevator going up and Bruce Willis is staying behind and he was crying. He was actually looking at a tennis ball on a stand because Bruce Willis wasn't going to be there for that. So, you know, I mean, that happens a lot in these movies.
Oh yeah.
They just need an eye line.
Yeah. Pretty much. But I mean, it's cool that he's releasing these pictures though, to be able to see.
Hashtag release the Green Lantern scene's been trending all day, by the way. People really want to see this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we do.
Hellblazer said you really had to go there, Junkman, with the Kathleen Kennedy thing. That's funny.
I've learned that's the answer to it's two things: Trump's fault, Kathleen Kennedy's fault. It's two things I've learned.
Pretty much,
not the good political.
Yeah, no, no, but that it's pretty much. I mean, you know, like you got a 50-50 shot there, and nowadays Warner Brothers kind of like inching its way in there to take a third of that business. So,
pretty much.
Yeah, but no, I wanted to look at those because I think that I just think it's cool that stuff is still coming out. Zack is still showing us stuff, you know, that had to do with it, you know, that we didn't get to see. And
still talking to fans on Vero, by the way.
Yeah. It's good that he's showing everybody what could have been and what won't be. I'm just saying there's no other he's leaking it out.
I'll just say this. He said Warner Brothers doesn't want him. There's a difference between that and HBO Max.
Not really.
They're different companies under the same umbrella. There is a difference.
But they still are gonna have to answer to Toby in many cases. So it's like look at the hierarchy, man. I'm just saying this is what people are really overlooking.
Getting my pistachios up, by the way.
I'm just saying that to say that it won't happen now is jumping the gun a little bit.
I will eat crow if I'm wrong. I have no problem with that. And it's like the whole reality.
How do you like your crow seasoned?
God, garlic would be good. I like garlic quite a bit.
He also likes to be cooked rare.
Sure. Jarbo eats it just ferociously.
I just bite the head off. I just geek it like a chicken.
Well, look, I will just say this to everyone. Okay. Like we were talking about a minute ago, like, you know, a few minutes ago about Star Wars, for example, right? And how long Star Wars fans waited between Return of the Jedi and you know, the Phantom Menace, for example, and those dark times when there looked like there was nothing. And look, we just, as DC fans, we've just gone through 4 years of waiting just because, you know, there's a month of this. And yes, we know. See, I don't think that Zack answering this on Vero the way that he does, like about Warner Brothers. I think Dawson's absolutely right. Nobody is under the delusion that Warner Brothers gives a crap about him. But I will just tell you this because I know that Matt has a differing opinion, and I know that Matt's taken a lot of lumps from people this last couple of days because of it, you know, and I've even joked with Matt about this stuff, whatever. And look, some of us are going to have it. What I don't want is I don't want those fans out there, for example, like our good friend Barcy here, who says, you know, I think it's over. I've been hopeful for a long time. Here's the thing, Barcy. Don't let somebody steal your faith about this, because here's the thing. There, just because there are people out there right now who are saying this isn't going to be or causing issue for it to happen, I can tell you there are many, many different ways that this.
And he froze.
Did I freeze?
Kathleen Kennedy's fault again.
Did I freeze?
Yeah,
for a second.
Okay. I'm telling you, they want to shut me up, but they ain't going to shut me up. I'm just saying there are. OK, so I understand Matt is an analytics guy, and I understand that Matt, you know, like I totally get where you're coming from the outside perspective on it and looking into it. And there's many things that you would normally look at this thing and go, yep, nope, this is it. Right. This is done. And so that's why I'm mad at you. I am mad at people who are frustrated about it, for sure. All I can say is there are still many ways that it can happen, and there are many ways that Zack wants to do it.
But here's the thing, though, and I have to go after this, but I just want this to be a food for thought situation. Is it right for us as fans to almost demand, if you think about it, because it is a demand, it's not a request, it is a demand, that a person who spent 10 years working for a company who clearly doesn't want him to go back into that emotional stress and that emotional trauma to continue telling stories? The truth of the matter is, Zack has said multiple times that he will not say no to a paying customer. He does not want to let anybody down. But I think if we are truly fans of him and not just what he creates, then it would be better served for us to put our attention towards Army of the Dead, which is a place where he's going to find grander,
I agree. I agree. That's why I will just tell you that the solutions that end up coming may not be what people expected.
And the thing is that if Zack does go back, do you really think he's going to go back to the exact same situation without maybe demanding something else? No, if he goes back.
Has Warner's changed anything really, even under new leadership?
What he would do. If it's with HBO Max, which is what it would be, because like he said, Warner Brothers is not someone that he probably doesn't want to work with.
It ain't going to be a theatrical release.
It ain't going to be theatrical. The thing is, if he does it with HBO Max, he's going to have a little set of demands. He's tasted a bit of freedom with Netflix. They didn't bother him at all with his movie. They let him make his movie. So he's going to demand, hey, if I do this, don't you be messing around with my stuff. I want to do this the way I want to do it without people interfering like Netflix, you know, allowed me to do without interference, right? He's going to demand that. You know, there's ways that it would happen. And people keep saying Warner Bros. Owns DC, Warner Bros. Owns DC. Like, yeah, but HBO Max is under the same company umbrella as AT&T, which AT&T oversees everything. So they can work out deals and stuff like that. There's things that could happen. Like,
but
just because Warner Bros.
This is the thing, though. When you're talking about verticals, this is what you're talking about, right? Mm-hmm. And it would have to go all the way to Keelar. That would have to, that's who it would have to get to, right? In order to make the deal work. The problem with that, though, is that it's been over a month and they've said nothing. Not a damn thing. Keeler hasn't said a damn thing about it, right? And so if he is in the rumor in the grapevine, and I keep hearing this all the time, is Keeler's a big fan, man. He's going to save it. Well, then why hasn't he said one thing? Why hasn't he come out and said that at least they were very happy with how it performed?
Dude, those are all good questions. But here's what I'm saying. Again, back to Barcy. Okay, this is what I'm saying. Those are all good questions to ask. And I am not like sitting here going pie in the sky, like demand this or demand that, or, you know, because look, and here's something that Darren can relate with, is that I don't want this to become the Phantom or the Fandom Menace. I don't want this to become something where all of a sudden we're hating on people and things so much that we actually become this toxic fandom that people want to blame us for, whatever. Okay. What I'm saying is that, yes, those are all good questions to ask. Any of all this, those are good questions to ask. But when I see Barcy and her faith, and I hear others who message me every day saying, is there really a chance? Is there really a chance? Look me in the eye. Yes. Yes. There are some questions that we need to ask. There are some definite things out there, but we as fans have a voice. We need to use that voice in a positive way. We need to be positive. We need to be respectful in how we do this and not turn into the thing that we say that we hate. And not just saying, well, Warner Brothers has done this and they treat this person like crap and they treat Zack like crap and they've done this and they've done that, and just be angry, because that's what I see other fandoms that I'm involved in doing. Okay. What I'm saying is you can keep the faith and know this. There are absolutely things. There's a lot of people guessing out there, putting things out into the public saying, well, I think this and I think that. And some of those things are definitely good questions to ask. But at the end of the day, there's some ways that this can happen. There's the ways that this will probably happen. And
three of them,
there's another couple things, Dawson, that are very interesting, actually, that I have come across. But here's the thing. It will be things that absolutely fans will have to go, okay, I can accept that, or I can accept this. It may not be exactly what you think you want, or how you think it should be made, or who you think you should make it, or whatever. But at the end of the day, if I get Zack's vision, that's all I care. I just want to know what was in that story. It's like being back in the day, Darren, when we were reading those, you know, Starlog magazines and stuff like that, and just like wondering like what happened here with Star Wars and what were the Clone Wars and all those things. I don't care that George Lucas directs it, or George Lucas, you know, produced it, or all these different things. You know what I care? I care that I know the story, that I learned the story, and that I know going forward. And so that's what I want.
And here's a question I want to pose to 187 in the chat. He says, too late, y'all pissed Warner Brothers off, LOL. Here's the question. Which is more of a problem? Us as fans pissing off Warner Brothers, or Warner Brothers pissing off the fans of the properties they own?
In my opinion, well, I've said this before, I honestly think if they don't get into the Snyderverse, it's going to haunt the studio forever. It'll be a ghost that haunts them, just like not releasing
exactly
back in 2017 does.
And they'll have lost all those fans that would have happily paid them for that content basically forever. A lot of them, they would lose them forever. They'd lose out on that money they would have had. So it's more damage for them to, or I guess for, yeah, it's more damage for the fans to be upset at them than the studio to be upset with fans. Them being upset with the fans doesn't matter.
77,000 downvotes on a video. Who cares about a trailer for a dead ass movie, right? 77,000 downvotes and open calls to keep downvoting it. That is the optics. So I see what you're saying about that, but this is what they're going to use to discredit you going forward.
But here's the thing, and this is I think the last thing we can bring somebody else in and whoever's
got. I got to respond to that though.
I want to respond to that though.
Okay.
So the whole downvotes thing, and I think I mentioned this to you in that comment on in the comments on YouTube. YouTube likes and dislikes buttons are basically surveys for people.
They are.
They tell you exactly if people liked it or didn't like it in the majority. It's a survey.
It's not a survey when you don't actually, like in this case, fine, I would grant you that only because of the comment section. But in general, that means nothing to YouTube. Okay, it really doesn't mean anything to YouTube. I'm talking about Warner Brothers.
Look, if you have a bunch of fans going to a trailer you released and you see it has a ton of dislikes, then that's a sign to you as a studio that obviously what you put out there is not something the fans like.
But do you think they don't already know that? I mean, it's pointless. Well, it sends
a clearer message.
The Snyder Cut is out. How would it send a clearer message?
It's a clear message that, hey, they want to continue. They want to say that Justice League from 2017 is their canon. And so if the fans say, hey, no, we don't want that to be the canon, they maybe will rethink some things because like, okay, the fans really don't like this. They're our paying customers.
They really don't like this. But they're not going to do that, though.
My point is this.
What do we care?
Yeah, we don't care if we piss Warner Bros. Off.
I don't care because this is not where I'm going to get that anymore.
Yes, because guess what? It's all part of the overall the same. There's distribution. There's vertical.
What if it doesn't need distribution?
If you want certain things to happen, it's going to require certain. Do you think that the Snyder Cut coming out on home video in a couple weeks is not going to be put out through Warner Brothers Home Entertainment? That's coming out through Warner's distribution. So if you're going to buy that on 4K, you're giving money to Warner directly.
But when you're talking about ticking off Warner Brothers Pictures over
but do you? But here's the thing:
digging up 2017's Justice League that everybody thought sucked, everybody thought was a bad movie. Nobody liked the critics didn't like it, the fans didn't like it, the newbies didn't like it. It was a horrible movie, a box office bomb. It was all those things.
Yep.
And so I get it. Look, I'm not saying it's necessarily a.
So then why attack it? Why attack it? If it's meaningless and no one liked it, why attack it?
I'll explain that. Because
we're gonna like get back on some pop culture stuff here in just a minute, but we're just gonna have this out.
And I'm gonna say this and then I gotta dip. But the thing is the reason fans are upset with that trailer is because there's been so many exposés, so many interviews of cast members and writers and directors alike. Talking about all the crap that went down in the reshoots of that movie to make that Justice League 2017 movie a reality. There's all these different mess of things that happen behind the scenes, and it's put a sour taste in the mouths of fans. But putting out that trailer shows that Warner Brothers doesn't care. Like, hey, a lot of messed up stuff happened in this movie. We screwed over a director. We screwed over actors. We don't care. We don't care at all. And it's a big F you to the fans. Which, of course, if someone flips you off and says F you, you're not going to like it.
But really, I mean, because like, let's be real. The Snyder Cut fandom is smaller than a lot of people think. It really is.
It's also bigger than a lot of people think.
A lot of people who don't pay attention. But the thing is, it's not as big as you want it to be. And that has been seen by the numbers that we have with that.
How big do you think it is?
I think it's maybe at most couple... because the thing is though, like, you know, if you look at it from like, let's say there was Sword of the Snyder versus 1.5 million tweets... You know, that's just a cumulative effort. I don't know. I have to go through and count. There's a lot of people. But what I mean by this is that it clearly did not do what we needed for it to do in order to get ahead.
But what's the question, though? How big do you think?
I can't tell you how big it is. I don't know. But I can tell you that it moved mountains to get it finished because it's easier than moving forward. It is. It's easier than putting up the money for another feature or another series or whatever. That's where it's at, right?
Robin R is a great comment here. The dislike button is there for a reason. If I don't like something, I dislike.
True.
all but of us you, create but, stuff on YouTube.
But let me
anything controversial about, for God's sake. I mean, my goodness, like that.
But
that's
the difference, Enosh.
Here, my gosh, Darren puts out great content. It's like the most benign thing ever. And yes, he pokes the bear sometimes. But you know what? The thing is that you know what? People come for you. They've come for you, Jarbo. They come for
everybody. Come for me all the time.
That's what I'm saying.
I don't care.
It's like, you know,
but hold
know why,
on, hold on. But let me,
Warner
because
it,
you have like, to look at it from the optics perspective. Okay. The optics perspective is you've got Ohio Dave telling people to downvote, and you have Zack saying cross the line, not saying don't downvote, not saying don't engage negatively, not saying stay positive. What it appears in those images and what they're going to use is that it is an outright call to downvote that video, that trailer.
So
it's, this is where, again, if you want to see this shit continue, you need to think of the optics. This is not a get angry type situation here. Getting angry and pushing for 4 years to get something made that was already shot, that was one thing. Now you're into the next phase. You're into the big leagues. You have to start thinking smart. And the thing is, I don't see smart thinking coming out of this fandom. What I see is over-entitled reactionary children who don't understand the politics of the industry from where we are right now, and all they want to do is beat their chest and cry into their echo chamber. That's what I see. And I've seen this kind of stuff play out before, and I'll tell you this, and then I really do got to go. But I've noticed there's been a massive escalation in the past few weeks since started coming on in.
Sorry, I hit the wrong button. Okay,
well, no, what I'm saying is I
didn't mean to do that to you, honestly.
No, it's fine. It's fine.
You but mentioned echo chamber and I accidentally hit the video instead of my thumbnail for this.
That's fine. But ever since the members of the Fandom Menace came in, there's been a massive escalation of negativity. A lot more of it. And platforming those people who have been known to abuse and attack and belittle people only takes away from the good that this group has done. And that is my opinion. You can take it or not. I really don't care. But that's what I see. And that's why I believe what I believe at this point, because I'm watching this happen from the outside looking in.
And I'll say this, and I also do have to go. But at the end of the day, we as a community of fans, we all are united in the fact that we, of course, wanted to see the Snyder Cut. We saw the Snyder Cut. We support Zack Snyder. And we also have seen all the mess of stuff that went down behind the scenes of Justice League. Now, basically saying, hey, I know all you people. Like, there's people who weren't aware of the video. It's like, hey, show Warner Brothers you don't want this as a fan and show that you don't want it by downvoting it, which is exactly what it's there for. If a company puts out a trailer for a movie, even if it's old or new, and you get a ton of downvotes from fans, that's showing you as a studio, hey, we don't care about this. We don't care. We're not going
to
pay for
this. And they're not looking to get your money because they already know you don't care. That's the other side of it.
And why else put out the trailer?
Because they just announced DC Fandom. They just announced DC Fandom. It was the same day.
I've heard you say that, Matt, but even that still doesn't make any sense because just because DC Fandom's coming out, we're going to talk about a movie that came out 4 years ago?
Yeah, because that's their canon. Because the Flash is going to take off of that. Shazam 2 is going to take off of that.
It's the fans saying they don't want that to be canon.
But here's the thing. But at this point, though, they can argue that those aren't real fans.
If I may, like, what is the answer then? How should fans voice
the fans? You figure out the best way to
be canon.
Right. Well, how you create a letter writing campaign, right? You start mailing.
We saw how that worked out before.
Letter writing
campaigns. They call us toxic for that one.
They call you toxic for anything. That is fair. That is true. But if you got the attention of Jason Kilar once, you could do it again.
What was the show that came back because of candy bars?
That was Jericho.
Yeah.
We
have to breathe. And then Warner Brothers was like, oh, they're toxic. Like, literally, honestly, we can simply call out Warner Brothers for the toxic behavior. And then Warner Brothers will come out with an article through some trade saying, we're being harassed by Snyderverse fans. It's like, no, we're calling you out for your BS, your terrible behavior. Yeah,
that's a great point. Like, they've already said things about it. Like, literally.
So why do the optics, according to you, Matt, matter if they already have that?
Because if you
want
it to continue, you have to play the long game. This is not long game tactics. This is just, I'm mad in the moment and I want to react.
See, Matt, I would understand your point if a bunch of fans were like just posting a crap ton of videos saying like F you Warner Brothers and flipping off the camera. But this is literally a freaking button on YouTube we're talking about here.
It doesn't. It's the optics of what the button is. All right. And YouTube at this moment in time is also trying to do away with dislike bomb campaigns. That's another thing that's happening behind the scenes at the platform. This is what I pay attention to. This is what I do. So they're already trying to figure out a way to make sure that kind of stuff doesn't happen, because it does negatively impact the video and it could negatively impact the channel and the algorithm. There are long-term effects. There are absolutely long-term effects to campaigns like that.
So you're more worried about, you're more worried about the Warner Brothers channel.
I'm worried about like I said, there's optics involved here.
I think what he's trying to say is that Warner Brothers sees an attack on their channel and their influence on YouTube as, on the social media platform, as the issue that they can use against Snyder fans. I think that's what he's trying to get at.
They're going to use everything they can to tell you all the time that it's over. All right. Zack will sit there and he'll make his comments that he does. He tries to be nice about it. But again, it is most likely not going to continue in the way that people are going to want. And the thing is, they can come out and say it's a comic book, it's a graphic novel, it's an animated movie, it's a whatever. If it's not live action with Ben and Henry and Gal, they're going to lose their minds over it.
I don't believe that.
I absolutely do. That's what I have seen from a lot of people. I've seen a lot of negative stuff that's come out of this stuff in the last couple of days.
I myself personally have said, if it's an animated movie, I'm totally okay with
it. I'm for it.
I'll take film puppets at this point. As long as I get a resolution. All I want is a resolution. Mm-hmm. Claymation, yeah. Sock puppets. I just want a resolution so I can feel good about all this other stuff that you're trying to force feed me. But right now, as I've always said,
I don't even care if they get like toys. Buy some toys and just have the actors like.
Here you go. Here's Justice League 2 and 3 right here coming up right here. I got my superpowers, guys. Look at there. We got the Superman everybody wants to see. We got Darkseid there. Oh, he's taking him down. It's gonna be great. And throw in Brainiac. Bring in Brainiac. We haven't seen Brainiac in a while. Let's throw in Brainiac for some stuff.
As far as the optics,
Gal Gadot in there. Da, 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 da. There she is.
Yeah. Like, as far as the optics
goes, Spikey Steppenwolf has been there. And everybody... Oh, you know, just bring right, in back
guys,
Henry
I'm like
Cavill.
20 minutes late for my own stream.
Back Henry Cavill, just taking them all out.
Stocked there, too. Yeah, as far as the optics goes,
he's gone.
they put it in the public domain, and or wrong, if you're a major multimedia company, you're in the public domain. It's like being the president and being mad because they write cartoons about you or they make parody about you. So SNL,
no, the thing is, like, I get where Jabba's coming from, and I like he does, like, I should clarify this for him since he's not here. He said multiple times he wants to see it continue. He's not like trying to hate on and say he doesn't want it to happen. He's just trying to be a realist.
Oh no, and I agree.
Well, look, I get it, but Matt is also he's an antagonist too, and so he sees something and he's going to take it to the furthest place that he possibly can.
Because, and I like Jarbo to a certain extent, but like this is a really weird hill for him to die on. Like a really
weird
hill.
It's weird.
He's really dying.
Like, again, I would understand if like literally people were going to Warner Brothers and harassing employees. I understand that argument. Like, yeah, that's not a good look, but literally downvoting a video is like, that's.
Well, he's explained it a bunch of times though. Like I don't want to speak for him necessarily, but he was on my stream earlier today and other times he's talked about this too. It's like, I get where he's coming from, that the executives, they're not thinking like us fans. Like for us, we don't see a big deal with dislikes. To them, they can use that as ammo. I get where he's coming from on that, because the way he understands YouTube and algorithms and stuff, I get where he's coming from in that regard.
But you know what, dude? That's like saying that Warner Brothers like shooting at you, or like Disney's shooting at you with cannons, and they're like, oh well, don't give them more ammunition. They're literally already shooting at you with whatever. It's just, you know, I would say more Warner Brothers. I mean, I say Disney just joking because of, you know, what we get told, but I just it's like at some point, like, I'm not telling everybody to go get angry and go take down a studio and do us, because I think that's silly and stupid, and I've spoken out against that, you know, when it comes to Disney and stuff.
But we will talk about their incompetence.
Yeah, I will talk about the incompetence that's there.
Well, here's the thing too, like we talked about this. It's like, well, they released the trailer because it's DC fandom. They could have done anything else. Why not do like a video saying, "Hey, The Flash is currently filming," and Ezra Miller waves to the camera and says, "Hey, guys, I'm filming the movie now."
But no, the Justice League trailer was a total FU to Snyder Cut fans. It was an absolute.
I think it was honestly bait. I think it's because they knew what they were doing. They knew the kind of response it was going to get, and they were prepared for it. And I think
how many downvotes did it get?
Us too.
It got like 77,000.
I think currently it's like 77,000, 78,000.
That's not even that many then.
No.
It could be millions. It could be millions. But what they're looking at is they're using the Snyder Cut fan base to stir things up so that it keeps us engaged into what they're going to do next. But like I said, don't engage with them because they're not this war with Warner Brothers is useless because, like I said, the next step, this last step didn't come from them. So why would the next step come from them? Why would you? They're doing exactly what a major film company that has always done. They're using their information and doing their thing, but it's not going to come from them. So they're getting twisted about, you know, they could put on a trailer, you know, any trailer they want to. I don't think anybody's buying it, that 4K that, you know, they're advertising. I don't know why they put it out.
No. Well, here's the thing. That trailer was not advertising a new 4K release. It was just a 4K up-res conversion of a previous trailer. The 4K for Joss League came out, like, back in 2018.
Hi, yeah. Nana. How you doing?
Nana was on Mad Max's stream. She did a great job on that.
Was she really?
Yeah, she had. Max did a ladies' night panel, which is great.
Hold on a second.
Like you're in Just Like a Woman and show up?
No. I thought Tiff was supposed to be on that.
She was. I think she was busy or something. I don't know. It was earlier tonight. I don't know what happened.
I wonder what happened. Oh, you know, I know what happened. Tiffany was setting up our outside patio thing. We bought a new little thing. Yeah. So.
Well, hey, I do got a dip. Got to get up in the morning.
We're gonna tick off all the Phantom Menace people because we're gonna have a ladies' night here at the Poindexter Lounge where my wife just comes in and talks about her things. She's gonna have her. I'm gonna set her up. She's gonna have her own drops. She's gonna have her own guests, and they're gonna talk about all kinds of nerds.
Is Jolene gonna be one of the guests?
Jolene might show up if I can find the wig again.
These guys are anti-women or something? Am I getting that?
Is that the fandom? Oh, well, don't even see. You know what I love? So me and Junkman can have a talk about that, and you all, and then William, you can sit on the outside of that for like 15 minutes and be like, I don't know what's going on. Oh yeah, no, the Phantom Menace people. We've already been into that, but yeah.
Did you hear there's a woman in the new Indiana Jones movie?
I did. It is absolutely. But hey, Dawson, why don't you tell everybody where they can find you, man?
Yeah, check me out on YouTube at this name right here, Nerdy Many Ways. Also Twitter at NIMW32. Facebook, you can check my Nerdy Many Ways Facebook page, Instagram, same NIMW32. And all that. Yes, I'll be having my podcast tomorrow at 3:30 PM. It'll be a live stream and I'll post the audio later on to Anchor and Spotify. So be sure to check that out. Also, we just recently posted the audio for our latest Four Nerds episode with Ty Roberts from Pop Culture Corner. So yeah, thanks for having me, man. It was great to be here for the first time in a long time, actually.
Yeah, man. It's good to see you, buddy. It's good to see you, man.
Great to see you guys too. Great to meet you, Junkman, as well as RJ and William. Always good to see you.
Hey, what's going on, man? Yeah. You just leave when I come on. Like, would I fart or something? And just
Two people are
leaving. I just got here, man. But that's okay.
William's smell in the air, man. We just all want to get away.
I know why the guy with the glowing eyes had to go.
Yeah. See you guys. Good night.
All right, Dawson. We'll see you, man.
But that like button, listen, it's like giving somebody a survey and saying, don't answer the negative answer. Don't click one. If you really didn't like the service, they put themselves in the public domain and that is part of the reality. And YouTube saying, well, we're going to fix that. The only way you're going to fix that is to get rid of the button. But that's data though. That's analysis. If I'm, you know, that's the difference between the film company and the streaming. If I'm looking at that and there's 77,000 people now, what if my market share is 250,000 units that I'm trying to sell? I already know that 77,000 people that are familiar with whatever I'm doing are not on board with it. That's going to change my math on whether I even want to spend the money on anything or how much I spend. If that's a test market and somebody's giving me that many downvotes, that's almost a third of your audience that says, I don't like this. So if you're smart, you're thinking, okay, so that downvote can actually be taken in an analytic way if you're thinking in those streams, but it's there for a reason. There's no rules under the download.
I think there's a fine line in between people who are just saying that, like acting like it's bullying or something to go and down, you know, look, and I've been on the receiving end. God knows we did a 2 cents on nonsense about Star Wars theory. And all of a sudden the down votes just went up and up and up and up. And I was like, what the heck happened here?
I didn't know you did one.
It was classic. Star Wars theory, you know, he did a video where it wasn't even his theory. Like he got an email from somebody about something else. That's where we get the,
this thing that we throw up every once in a while, this Talama Park Wall thing. I am a Palpatine. Are you familiar with that, Darren?
No.
Okay. So this was classic. This was, we laughed so hard, man. I had to download this picture for it at the time because the whole idea was, and it was this guy, I guess his name is Toby. He sent this to Star Wars Theory, and look, Star Wars Theory is one of the biggest channels on YouTube. He, you know, a lot of people love him. He's got a lot of kids and stuff like that watch him, and, you know, and he's a huge Star Wars fan, and I get that. But the thing was, we did a 2 cents on nonsense, not attacking him at all. We were not attacking him at all. We just talked about how silly this theory was because this guy sent him this thing and was saying that in Star Wars, the Force Awakens, you know, the very first thing that you hear Rey yell is when she yells at the junk trader who's hauling BB-8 away. Right. And she yells at him, Talama Pakwa, Talama Pakwa. And of course, in The Rise of Skywalker, we found out that she was a Palpatine. Okay. So this was the theory. And this is the actual sheet of paper was if you look at Talama Pakwa and you take the T and so first of all, you take the L in Talama and you take it down and you turn it into the I. And then you take that A, which is the second letter, and you turn it upside down and put it at the end. And then you take it and then you take that T and you bring that over there. Oh, and then you take AMA, which is M-A. And then you take Parkwall. So you just bring the P down. You bring the A down. But you bring the Q down, but you flip it around and make it a P. And then you take that U and flip it upside down and make it an N. Then you take this T, that's the T from over there. And then you bring that L over and put it where it needs to be in that A. You just bring it down. So my thing was how do you know what to just bring down? How do you know what to flip over? I don't know. But you get her saying, I am a Palpatine.
Are you sure this wasn't uploaded on April 1st?
No, this was serious. This was serious, Darren.
Is like, it a video?
It's a video. Yes, it is a video.
I'm not making a parody of that. I'm making a parody of that next week.
Oh my gosh. And so look, Johnny and I saw this and
I've got to find that.
Oh my gosh. I'll have to find it and send it to you, dude. Johnny and I saw this and I was like, what in the world is this? And so here's the thing. We did our 2 cents on nonsense about it. We laughed so hard because it is. Like, let's be honest. Look at this, right? I mean,
just to clarify, was this theory made after Rise of Skywalker or before?
Yes, like, it was after Rise of Skywalker.
Okay, so they weren't trying to predict that she was.
No.
That would have been amazing.
Oh yeah. Oh, that would have been. Then I would have gone like, this is a soothsayer.
I would have been in a museum somewhere.
To which I might have ticked off a couple of people yesterday because you know that they just had that Star Wars comic book that came out this week. Remember we were talking about it that the Emperor's had Luke's hand this whole time, and that Snoke is a possible clone from Luke's hand, and so or a strand cast or whatever. And so my thing was hold on a second, because there was also the idea that he's been using this to make clones of himself that he was putting his essence into that he is in there. So if he used that same technology to make a strand cast clone of him that became his son, because he couldn't have force powers though. So that son grew up and had, and got married and had a daughter, which was Palpatine's granddaughter. So really that makes Rey a combination of both Palpatine and Luke, which means she actually is a Skywalker. To which I was like, no. That doesn't.
And it also like imply that she kissed one of a blood relative.
Well, yeah, would it be her cousin?
Sounds like a Skywalker.
Hey, like a Targaryen.
It sounds just like a Skywalker, doesn't it? Like, so is it, because somebody asked me about that. Maladdin actually sent me that question here on the channel. He sent me this and he's like, he said something about her brother. I said, well, it wouldn't be her brother. I said, at best, it would be a cousin. Maybe at worst it would be her
aunt nephew, wouldn't it? It would. She would. He would be her nephew.
But if you're a clone,
like you're not really that person. So I don't know how that works. All I know is we did our 2 cents on nonsense on this.
That's more than two cents of nonsense.
Yeah, we did our thing. And the thing is that it sat there and it was fine. Everybody just got a kick out of it until a few days later when Star Wars Theory saw it and brought it up on his live stream and watched the entire episode of 2 cents on nonsense on his live stream. Oh, he did.
That helps you.
Oh my gosh.
Was he upset or what?
No. So you know what? Here's the thing. He did skip a couple of round parts about it. And like, I think that he got it. He didn't seem upset. He's pretty chill. Like, I don't think I've ever actually seen him get really mad at anything.
No, he seems like a really nice guy.
He seemed pretty chill about it. And like, he even told everybody, you know, hey, don't go over harassing these guys. You know, they've got an opinion. We've got an opinion, whatever. But like, I think he did misinterpret it as we were attacking him, where we weren't attacking him. We were attacking really anything. We were just laughing about this theory, and it wasn't even his theory. But here come the 11-year-olds. And it was hilarious to watch it in real time because like all these kids came over downvoting the video and leaving these horrible things in the comments. And they're like, they were cheering each other on. They're like, yeah, let's get them. Let's take this channel down. We're going to show them for Star Wars Theory and stuff. And it was funny because the kid who was leading the whole thing, I ended up like messaging him and I said, hey, man, I saw that you have a channel. And he had like 4 subscribers, and then I subscribed to his channel, and like he's like this, he was literally, because I was like, who is this jerk of a person? And then like I realized, like I listened to one of his videos and it was like he's like a kid. And so I was like, oh. And so I immediately like I messaged him and I said, hey man, you know what, I get it, man. You're defending a YouTuber you like. I totally understand. I said, you know what, hey, I subscribed to your channel. And the next thing he did was he posted, he's like, hey guys, you know, I don't think they were trying to be rude after all. Like, I think that these guys were just having fun. Like, even Star Wars Theory told us that it was okay. Like, hey, you know, let's take our downvotes back. And then all of a sudden it was weird because like it went back up. It was like
romance.
Yeah. And all of a sudden he's like, yeah, you know, these guys are good. He's like, I actually just subscribed to them. These guys aren't so bad. And you know, so but I agree. I think there's a fine line in probably trying to arrange or like get everybody ticked off, you know, it's something and go and like, you know, like mass vote. But I don't know that it's bullying. I don't know that it's
What I understand from YouTube is YouTube don't care if it's up or down or the comments. They see us interacting. So if somebody gives me 100 thumbs down, hey, it's gonna
YouTube. I think what Jarbo was trying to say though is that the dislikes affect the algorithm for a video, so it might not perform the way they want it to. He's not here to make the comments.
No, that's public domain. He said that the other night too. But yeah, like
it's supposed to be any interaction, good or bad. Comment sections got a lot of going on. The thumbs up or thumbs down, they see it as people are interacting, so they push it out there.
That's what they tell us. That's exactly what they tell us.
And if you don't like it, you have the choice not to enter the public domain with certain things. But once you enter that public domain, you can't really control.
But would it have been better if fans just like ignored the trailer, like didn't watch it, didn't leave any comments or any likes, like or dislikes? Would that have been a better strategy or like what?
No, because it really would have been false. It would have been, they did organically what people who don't like something do, and the option for them to do it was there. It wasn't like they circumvented something or created something or went out of their way. The option to show displeasure, and there's no gauge or no rules of what your displeasure is. There's no fine print under that button that says you are not allowed to push this down button unless you meet these exact criteria. Now, it's there. It's blatantly there, up or down. It's that simple. Now, if they want to complicate it and make rules about it, then that's up to YouTube. But once you put something in a public domain and you create a tool for people to use, they use the tool. Now,
mad at them for using the tool. You know, RJ, you know, you said this, and I think this goes along with Andrew's comment here with this $5 super chat. Thank you. I had this up earlier and I never read it. $5 super chat. Thank you, Andrew. Says there was absolutely no point in them re-uploading that trailer if the fandom announcement was the reason why. Was the reason why didn't they re-release other trailers? And I think that's the point. Like that's what ticked people off, was that like it's not it would be like, I mean, my gosh, I mean, what would be the equivalent? I mean, it would be like
Disney releasing a 4K version of Star Wars The Holiday Special.
Yeah, but here's the thing. Like, even that, it would be like them not releasing it. Because like you said, RJ, to your point, it's not like they were just now putting out the 4K release of Justice League.
No, right? it was an up conversion of a trailer they already released like back in fall 2017, like October, I think. So
yeah, so there was just no point in it unless
they are trying to promote fandom. But then why not just do something where the Flash cast says, "Hey, the film's shooting now. You'll find out more at DC fandom. Bye, everybody." That would have been a smarter tactic to release that day then.
Yeah, it just
do
like
you think studios care that much? How about the thumbs up and thumbs down? I figure they got their own data. I don't think
this particular studio does. This particular studio doesn't care.
I don't think
this particular studio is detached. So, and studios in general probably don't. But this particular studio, I don't think has the kind of connection to this fandom that they think they do. I don't think they care. You don't hear Warner Brothers posting a letter saying, "You hurt our feelings. Please stop." They don't care.
I don't think studios care about the online community as much as people think.
Not at all.
They're going to go see it anyway. Probably going to see it anyway or talk
streamers
about it.
Streamers care, though. Streamers care. That's really important.
But studios probably got their own data.
Exactly. They're looking at all kinds of data, and they're probably looking at this. Now, if this was HBO Max and we were gonna do something with Justice League, Zack Snyder's Justice League, and we're dropping hints about something, and we're going to just drop you a tip on you or hint on YouTube, "Hey, we're going in this direction. What do you think?" It's like a weather balloon. Now, if I know I got about 500,000 people that are subscribing to me, and like I said, 77,000 or 150,000 of them say thumbs down on that, as a streamer, I'm not going to be, holy cow, we're going to change our course because this is our money we're messing with right here. Okay, whereas the studio, they don't care.
I like that. Junkman's got a bunch of cool Star Wars t-shirts. I know they keep trying to take them down, but oh, they're not Star Wars t-shirts. I mean, they're
some shirts. Of them. Junkmanmerch.com.
That is a great t-shirt, though. I love that one.
Yeah, I know. I saw this earlier. He always likes seeing all of our t-shirts when we work.
So I got an Avatar t-shirt.
Very cool.
You got your
oh, whatever. You and your creepy superhero shirt, your Shazam shirt. Look at you. And then here's my
Bandit
77 Bandit shirt. So good.
No, I love this t-shirt.
Like, thanks, John. By the way, thank you for the $2 super chat, man. I always like to. I know you always love seeing people's t-shirts on the show, so I think that's cool.
I'm just happy I found this.
Mine's just a lightning bolt.
So. I'm just happy I found this because I've always wanted more Avatar t-shirts, and they had one at Target. I was like, I gotta buy it. So,
yeah, like I said, I said, Resolution would solve all of this. There's one thing they could do to solve all of this, and that's to resolve it. Resolve it, and then you don't have any friction when you move on with your whatever candy universe you're going to do using the 2017 movie as your platform. If you want to go ahead and do that, I don't care. As long as you resolve this. Resolve this, and we're okay.
Here's the thing I keep coming back to, though. Like, they had to have known what kind of reaction they were going to get if they put that trailer out, though. There's no way that they knew that they weren't going to get disliked to hell and back.
But Warner Brothers proper, the studio, doesn't care about that.
See, that's what I was going to go back to, Darren's comment about that, because Darren's absolutely right. Like, look, all of us YouTubers, man, like the first time you get a downvote or you get a mean comment, you're just like, oh, what did I do? Like, you know, like those first few, you know, times, man, when you're just like fresh on YouTube and stuff and you're looking at it. I mean, I remember those days where it's like, why don't you like what I did? Like, especially if you put all this time into making this video, you know, and Darren and I have both talked about it, man. Like, how many videos, Darren, have you done where you've put your whole time and effort into and they just don't do anything?
Everyone I love the most tanking views, it seems like.
People ask me all the time. They're like, Enosh, why don't you do so many like, you know, pre-recorded edited videos anymore? I'm like, well, one, because I like doing these streams where I can actually talk to people and have the conversation. But you know, the other thing too is exactly that. I noticed like I put those out there and it takes forever for them to get any traction. People don't watch them right away and it's rough. It's hard, but you know, but the thing is, and it, especially when you're putting all your time and your effort into it, you know, it's not necessarily that, you know, it's not necessarily that only a few people watched it. It's just that like you put so much time and effort and people, you know, I don't think understand sometimes the editing process. I hate the editing process.
Editing's the worst part of anything.
Oh my God.
No, it takes me 20 minutes to record and 3 hours to edit.
Right. And then it doesn't work. Editing? Something doesn't work right.
Yeah.
right? Something doesn't export right. Look, yeah. I've been doing my intro here. I've got my intro like just on a file that just goes. And then the other night, like I noticed when I hit my intro, it was like all screwed up. And I was like, what the heck happened? And I've gone back through and like something glitched. And now I got to like re-put everything. And I was just like, you got to be kidding me. This is like
editing and making thumbnails are the worst parts.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. But you know, but that's the thing is like, that's part of it. But, you know, and like I said, with every negative comment, you feel like, you know, I remember feeling like I had to like answer these people, you know, and figure, you know, like, why don't you like me? You know, like, why do you hate me? And now I laugh because I love them. A junk man, junk man's got a whole series.
They gave me content. And I love to find a really bad one and pin it to the top. And then everybody else that watches my video, they take care of the guy. And I don't have to say nothing to them.
And yeah, totally, man. And that's just how, like, when I see some of the comments, you know what I love too is when people, they'll make a comment that's like especially mean and they don't realize that you still see it.
Yeah.
Right. Cause it still pops up. Right. And they delete it, you know, like they make it and then they delete it. And then they're just like, oh, well, you know, I had somebody who knows me in real life do that to me a few weeks ago. Ooh. Because they didn't like something that I did here on the channel. And they used this. This is, mind you, is a person who literally could have picked up their phone, called me up and been like, hey, Enosh, yeah, you know, I didn't quite like this, or texted me and just said, you know, hey, I didn't quite like. No, they figured that they would go ahead and use my comment section to tell me that they were leaving my platforms. They were leaving the Facebook page. They were leaving the YouTube channel. They were leaving the Twitter. They were leaving everything. And I'm like, okay. All right. I'm still going to make the content I make, like, you know, and then they tried to, oh, so the 11,000 other people are more important than me. Ooh, you got 11,000 subscribers and you think you're something. I'm like, okay, first of all, like, I don't think I'm something because I have 11,000 subscribers. In the bigger world of YouTube, I am still this little tiny ant. So I don't know what big head you think I have because I have 11,000 subscribers, but no, you know, but even then it's like, but yeah, I guess there's 11,000 other people who. Who they're here and they like my content, so
yeah. I hate those people that have to. I hate those people that have to depart. They're leaving. I'm like, just leave.
You don't have to tell me. No,
I'm announcing. I'm going. Yeah. And I'm taking all of my.
Somebody stop me! Somebody stop me! Is what they want.
Yeah, this isn't an airport. I don't need a big statement.
I'm sorry. I was just going to finish my comment on that. But that's the thing. It's like, so yeah. So for content creators, for smaller people like that, you know, like, you know, it's definitely a thing of sometimes you get frustrated, right, with some of those things. But I do not think for a second that Warner Brothers is up sweating 40,000-50,000 downvotes or whatever it is, 70,000 downvotes.
It's about to be 80,000.
Well, there you go.
Oh, you're 80,000, but that's not even
like you said. I think that they're looking at it from even what William said, probably as an analytics thing. You know, are they happy about it? Probably not. You know, but like the only people who talks about getting ratioed and ratioing people are people that are part of those, you know, fandoms, those menace fandoms that think that they're doing something by doing that, when all you're really doing, like Darren said, is
it's also oftentimes a lot of young teenagers, Twitter stands like to do that stuff to you. So
if you look at downloads, 80,000, if you add that up, how many tickets that would be, if they, it's not really that many when you think of it money wise.
Yeah,
80,000. If they lost 80,000 people, they wouldn't even notice.
They're looking at the internet as a microcosm, not even a good sampling. And that's what a movie studio is going to do, because with the particular people that are on streams, that watch streams, there are a certain percentage of people that are not going to make a blip on the box office needle. It's just not going to happen. But when you're talking about other platforms, streaming platforms, the interconnection between YouTubes and streams and blogs onto streaming platforms is huge. It's huge. It's a big part of their audience. So, but the Warner Brothers studio, the average Joe gets on his computer to check his email and watch some stuff, maybe get on Amazon or anything else. He doesn't get into the content creation. He doesn't get into the Enosh Poindexter Lounge type things, and most people don't. So Warner Brothers is basically, they're not going to listen to you on that platform because it doesn't affect their money, you know. But other platforms would be like, wow, that'd be a death knell if you know, out of 500,000 subscribers, anywhere between 80 to 150,000 didn't like it. I may want to listen to that simply because those are the guys who are going to be repetitive customers. Those are the guys who are going to lead to retention. A guy going to a movie, he may go to the movie maybe once a month, but the content you create on the stream, that guy's there every day. And not only that, he's on to your next thing. So once that content ends, he's on to your next show. So you got to treat him a little bit better because you could lose a guy for an entire year. Whereas on Warner Brothers, you're losing four tickets to a movie. So they're not going to care about they don't give one rat's ass about the downvotes. Well, they're like, probably looking at like what?
Yeah, like Barcy just said here, you know, WB never cared about us. You know, they've showed time and time again, like, that they don't like Zack Snyder. We know that they don't like Zack Snyder. They don't like what he did. They've tried to fire him so many times. They didn't want to give us the Snyder cut.
And Barcy points out this isn't the first time fans are at the campaign either. Young Justice got canceled. He had to fight tooth and nail for years to get a third season.
Yep.
It wasn't until they got DC Universe was a thing.
Canceled the comic too, yeah.
Now, as someone from the outside, let me ask if Warner Brothers don't care about fans or Snyder, why did they even do the Snyder cut? Why didn't they just say, we're moving
because
on?
Because it wasn't them. It wasn't them. They got that. Yeah. They got pushed to do it from AT&T and Warner Media. It was a streaming thing. If it was up to Warner Brothers, it would have never happened.
Plus, I'd like to add, too, I think the pandemic helped out a lot because HBO Max was like, hey, this thing, we can just get it done maybe about a year. It'll be great content. It'll boost our stream platform they really want to push.
So that's what number they care about a lot is how many people's clicking on that on their streaming and how many new memberships they're signing up.
That's why we keep making the point that like it doesn't really matter what Warner Brothers Pictures wants to do. Like, or like that they, if they don't want to, like, it doesn't, like, even if for some reason you wanted to make an argument, it's like, well, they don't hate the fans. Like, they don't hate what, you know, and like, I don't even want to get into that because it's a studio, right? So the studio is a business. The studio as a whole doesn't hate anybody. There may be people within there that don't care for different properties or different things or want to do things in their way. And that's kind of what's happened. They want to take things in their way and that's fine. But at the end of the day, you know, we already know that we're not going to get it from Warner Brothers. They're not going to put out a new Justice League movie by Zack Snyder in the theater. But with William talking about it, that's what we're saying is, like, if we get it, it's going to be on HBO Max anyways. It's going to be something else, you know, it's going to be a different thing. And, you know, we just, I think we just have to look at it that way. And as fans, I think somebody here, what did, oh yeah, I mean, Stella even here put it best. And by the way, thank you, Stella, for reaching out to me the other day. I haven't really had a chance to. I've had a bunch of messages and stuff, but I want to thank you for reaching out to me. Says stay subscribed to HBO Max. Look, if I watched HBO Max all day today, like, I was watching all kinds of stuff. I was in and out of sleep, but I was still watching HBO Max. There's a lot of great content on HBO Max.
Best streaming service out there.
If you find something on there, watch it. You know, if you got Disney Plus, watch it. Just enjoy what you enjoy. Everything doesn't have to be Zack Snyder's Justice League for you to enjoy the other content, you know? And like you said, like, you know, just keep watching what you love and doing that. Benson's here. What's up, Mark? With a 5-pound super chat, says 11,000 subs, maybe. But a video containing Russell Crowe, Gerard Butler, Louis Gossett Jr., and Jonah Hill
demands respect. Boy, I knew it was coming. I knew Condor Man was going to make it into my life at some point tonight. I just didn't know when.
The watch party for that, whenever we do, it's going to be legendary.
I might need 8 Benadryl for that
one. He does. You know what? Yeah, people say I look like Russell Crowe all the time. You know, Junkman, you do look a little bit like Gerard Butler.
Is it?
That's hilarious.
I'm seeing it. I'm seeing it.
Yeah, he worried that for?
Yeah. Well, somebody commented that I look like Gilbert Gottfried, so I'll take that.
I'll take Gerard Butler any day.
Yeah. What? Okay.
Oh, but yeah, that's hilarious.
This fight is taking place. I don't mind these guys fighting. I don't mind these fans fighting. I just would love if they knew where to fight. Because, like I said, give up on WB. It's not happening there. It never was. It didn't happen there. The only reason we are here is because AT&T and because you have the guy running the whole show is a streaming guy.
Honestly, it was smarter of the fans to comment on that trilogy trailer on the HBO Max YouTube channel. commenting, yeah, hey, we want more than a trilogy. It's not just a trilogy. Don't say it's a trilogy.
That's feedback. That's legit feedback. And I thought that was great, too. I agree there. But as far as all this other stuff goes, it's like I said, when you see these old school execs, I don't think they hate Snyder. I don't think they hate us. They're the dinosaur. Like I was telling a film junkie, they're the dinosaur, and they're looking up in the sky, and streaming is the meteor that wiped out the dinosaur. They don't know any other way to think operate than old school operating. And when you have something like this within your own company that feeds on your leverage and can feed on your budgets, these guys don't want to give up that power. And they see these guys are in their 60s. Dan Sarnoff is 58, 59. Imrock's in his 60s. These guys are set in their ways. They are not changing. They're not going to change for anybody when it comes to streaming. But unfortunately for them, there is the guy that they bought over who helped Hulu, who is the exec of two different streaming services, is moving the company in a different direction. And that's where your fight is. You know, it doesn't matter what WB says at this point about the Snyderverse, because they never said anything to begin with. It wasn't the people say, oh, well, they gave us the Snyder Cut. No, they didn't. Toby Emmerich answered a call from his boss saying, this is what I'm going to need you to do. That's it. When your boss tells you to do something, you do it, or you don't have a job. It wasn't some heroic, you know, he had the S on it, he ripped open his shirt and Toby Emmerich was Superman for us. It wasn't. You know, his boss saw the algorithm. He saw the first thing they did when they purchased that is they looked at all the trends that were relevant to AT&T and all the things that were relevant to the services that they had. And that's how they made decisions like getting rid of DirecTV, things like that. They studied all that data and restructured their company that way. And there's still more restructuring to come. Yeah. You're probably going
to
see another
example. AT&T sold off Crunchyroll to Sony. You know, they're getting rid of a lot. They're trimming off a lot of this that they own. So
a lot of the stuff that's not relevant to what where they're taking the company.
Well, you know what I think this is a good time for us to do as a fandom, and as we start to wind down this episode tonight and everything, is just this: is to take a good look, to take a step back, right? To take a breather. We've been going full tilt, man, on Snyder Cut stuff. We've been going full tilt on this for 4 years. Boom, 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 boom. Take a step back, take a breath, process. Don't allow our emotions to take over and start, you know, blasting things and, you know, and doing things. But like, really remember what this movement has all been about, right? Because if you think, I said this to somebody the other day, and I think this is a great way to kind of wind this down. As I said this to somebody the other day, this is if you think, because somebody said to me something like, well, you know, I hope you're happy. You got your movie. Now go away. And I said, see, that's the thing, is if you think that this was all just about the Snyder Cut, then you haven't been paying attention. Or you just don't know. Because what this has been about has been, one, yes, to see Zack Snyder's vision restored, because we knew that he had a movie. This is not just because we didn't like a movie that came out, you know, 4 or 5 years ago. Obviously, we didn't care for that movie, but that wasn't what we got upset about. You know, that's not what just like did it for us. It was that we knew that Zack had been wronged and his vision had been taken away. So we wanted to see him restored. We knew the tragedy that happened to Zack Snyder's daughter. We wanted to see justice for her because of what had happened, and that's what took Zack out of the film to begin with. So we wanted to see those things restored. It was always a positive thing. This fandom has raised $750,000 for suicide prevention. Those are the things, like this movement, it drew people together. Zack even said last year, if nobody even saw the Snyder Cut, that it was worth everything because of the fan interaction, because of the positivity that everybody brought. And then all of a sudden people started out of nowhere with this whole, it's a negative thing, trying to compare us to the Phantom Menace, trying to compare this and that. And that's why I say, to me, there's a huge difference. We're not just mad about something or don't like something or trying to, you know, demonize certain, you know, figures in whatever. We just wanted to see justice done. We just wanted to, ironically, you know, when you consider the name, but we just wanted to see something positive. And I think that's what we have to continue to do. Now, one of the things that I love is, and what I want to do, you know, especially even going forward here on the channel, we've talked a lot about, you know, the Snyder Cut and the Snyderverse, and we're still going to talk about it. You know, we're still talking about it. But you know what? I mean, William, you've been here. RJ, you've been here. Darren, you're here tonight. And I definitely want to do some more stuff with Darren, man, because I like Darren. Like
that avatar is absolutely hilarious. I'm looking at the Junkman's avatar.
Oh, it's great.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
I try to make one like that. It looks like a distorted zombie Tiger Woods. But all these other guys can make these avatars. And I'm literally looking at the person that I was just talking to, the real guy.
Somebody made it for me. I'll say that. I didn't make it myself.
Please send me a link to that, because mine have turned out abysmally horrible. And I look worse than where I look like OJ in one. And then when I had on, I looked like, and I had a red shirt, I looked like Tiger Woods. And I gave myself a golf ball thing, because it was horrible. So please help me out with that. I want an avatar that actually looks like the sleestack I am.
Yeah. Think about the conversations we had this week, right? And that was one of the things that, like, I was glad Darren popped in tonight earlier, because, like, with William, you were here, RJ, you were here, we were talking about, like, and William is like old school, like me and Darren, like going back to, you know, these good old days of Man of Stuff. Yeah. And we had this week, we've had discussions about old school TV shows. I mean, we went off about Dukes of Hazzard the other night about, you know, I had the Auto Man stuff already up because we did that. You know, we talked about Knight Rider. We talked about, you know, all these old shows, but we talked about all this new stuff too, that was coming out and all these different, we talked about the He-Man movie, you know, and the Master of the Universe movie, if it's actually ever going to really happen or not.
Yeah, I doubt it.
Way. Who knows?
We can talk about that. You talk about Blade Runner. 7 hours of just straight pure Blade Runner. I'm ready.
But that's what I'm saying. Like, so there are some. Oh, go ahead, Darren.
Believe it or not, I've never seen Blade Runner.
Me either. We should do a watch party, Darren, where you and I can actually watch it for the first time and bring in a couple of people like who have seen it and love it. And then that way we can give our opinions of like Blade Runner for the first time.
And I love Harrison Ford, but. And then when I want to watch it, everybody's like, watch this cut, watch that cut.
Listen to no one. I will lead you through the thickets and let you know exactly which one you need to watch, especially as someone who's never seen it before.
Yeah.
As someone who's never, a guy like me, 1,000 times, I can watch any version, you know. But for somebody like you who's never seen the original one before, there's a certain version that you really need to watch to really get the full breadth of the movie. You know, but let me know.
And that's the thing is I want to be able to go back to, man, when we were just talking about movies, look, movies are going to be kicking up again. There's going to be stuff that's, you know, as we're coming out of the pandemic and everything, there's going to be more and more stuff that's coming out. And so I think it's a good time for us to take a step back. Don't get all worried because it's been a month since the Snyder Cut or whatever. And we don't have all the numbers. We don't have all that stuff. Don't get paranoid. Don't get panicked. Like I put out yesterday on Twitter. I put out several different things. This reminds me of the Pa Kent moment for Man of Steel, where it's like Pa Kent puts out his hand and he just kind of tells Clark in that moment, you know what? You gotta accept this right now.
Let me die.
I want to make clear. I'm not saying let the Snyderverse die. I'm not saying that. I'm saying let these people do whatever they're going to do. These, the studio, the whoever's, right. Just keep making your voice heard. Just make it your voice heard, but do it in a positive way. And, I think we can make a great change that way. And look, you know, like I'm not saying that downvoting a video, if you don't like it and you look at it and you go, this really frustrates me. That's your right to be able to do. I know that there are people who look at it in a different way because they're a little more sensitive because they've had stuff happen to them. But, you know, I mean, at the end of the day, it's your right. Steven Moten, I love you, Steven. You're an awesome guy. Says Michigander, just like me, with a $4.99 super chat here, says there is precedent for a studio to change. The franchise was X-Men. Never lose hope.
Studio. I actually have more hope than that, because it was the entire studio that had to change here. Here we don't have to have that. The studio doesn't have to change for us to get what we would like out of this. The streaming service just has to catch up to us. And what my biggest advice to people is give them time. Give our allies, and they are there in the streaming service, give them time and give them the leverage that they need. They've proven that they recognize us, or else we wouldn't have had this cut to begin with. There are people in there that rely and live and breathe on numbers. Continue to give them the numbers. Continue to watch the content on there, and let this company evolve into what it will be. Warner Media will be a streaming focal point company when this is all said and done. And that's part of the game. And you got about 6 or 7 more months of sitting and waiting, because that's how long it's going to take for them to formulate a strategy based on what they have now or what they're continuing to have. You know, it's a new era. So, but yeah, let's enjoy everything. Enjoy everything that HBO Max has, Hulu, all this stuff. There's so much to talk about. Oh, and yeah. the one good thing about this entire movement is had they not screwed up and botched this movie, a lot of us wouldn't even be in the same circles. So,
yeah, no, I hear you. Talk about editing. This is something I got to do more, and I know I need to do more because we have these longer streams and stuff, and we have these great moments and stuff. And I've been actually working on this, Ryan, of actually trying to figure out ways to do this more to chop down certain segments of videos. It's a time thing, to be quite honest with you.
I've got two channels. I've got a live stream channel now where I put up clips. Mm-hmm. And that's worse than just because I have to find. It's hard. You got a 2-hour stream. You're trying to find that 5 minutes within a 2-hour.
Yeah, hey, Stella, the international cut. I'm seeing her. She asked me which one, William. The international cut. That's it. Don't throw the other ones away. Just take that one.
Okay. Well, there you go. I'm with you, Darren. Like I've looked at that so many times, and I'm like, I don't even know where to start. It's like Doctor Who. So many friends of mine are into Doctor Who, and they tell me like, Enosh, you would love this. I know you would. And I'm just like, okay, but like, where do I start with Doctor Who? Okay,
you're an old guy. I'll tell you. For a senior like you, you can start anywhere. You can start anywhere because of...
Yeah, but that's not an answer. I need an answer.
Where you can get the most enjoyment being of a certain age is the fourth doctor. You should start with Tom Baker. You should start with Tom Baker for you to get your grounding on the series. Oh, no, once you get through Tom Baker, then it doesn't matter where you go. Yeah, what's up?
Okay. You froze for a second.
But you could... Oh, okay. Yeah, Tom Baker, which he's the fourth doctor. He's the longest reigning doctor. He was from 1974 to 1981.
Okay.
And that was the first doctor that we had on American TV. Prior to that, it didn't air here, but it aired on public TV starting in the mid-70s, and he is the most well-known. But once you start with Tom Baker's doctor, you can just pretty much go to any era you want to because you get an understanding.
I mean, started with the 2005 reboot with Christopher Eccleston.
Most Americans did. Americans did because Doctor Who, remember, from 1989 up till 2005, there was no Doctor Who on TV. You had the one made-for-TV movie that included Doctor Number 7. After that, you didn't have it was BBC and the Sci-Fi Network, actually Sci-Fi Channel, that brought Sci-Fridays back, and then Doctor Who was one of the things that anchored it. So you started with Christopher Eccleston, Destro, and then you went on to what ended up being one of the famous favorite doctors of all time, which was David Tennant.
Oh, that's awesome.
David Tennant had a 5-year.
You know, but yeah. I never got to ask you this. What did you think of the live action G.I. Joe movies? Cool. The two that they did.
You know what?
Horrible, but hey.
Well, you know what? Look, I won't say it's horrible. The first
good movies, but not good G.I. Joe movies.
The first one.
Second one's better than the first one.
It is. The first one doesn't quite feel like G.I. Joe. It's got a kind of a strangeness to it. There's moments that feel like G.I. Joe. I love seeing Snake Eyes. I love seeing Storm Shadow. It felt like they combined Dr. Mindbender with Cobra Commander. So it was kind of weird.
How did you do that?
I know. It was just strange.
They fixed it in the sequel, though.
The sequel really felt like a G.I. Joe movie. I mean, you got to see the Cobra symbols. It was a plot that would definitely take place in a G.I. Joe cartoon, given the fact that Cobra was trying to take over the United States.
I'm excited for the Snake Eyes movies coming out this year.
I'm excited for that to be the starting point of something new. So am I, because they need it.
Let's get that.
Oh, dude. Hey, remember? Oh, hey, so cool. Speaking of toys, so these damn young cats up in here. Actually, there's only one. But remember when G.I. Joe did an excellent marketing campaign back in the 80s. They had their comic books, and then they had their toys. They would use their commercials for their comic books to push their toys, even though it was different.
Right. Like, it was different.
Yeah, Serpentor was a storyline that took place in the comic books, but he was also a toy, and then they would debut them with five-parters, like the Pyramid of Darkness was, oh, man. The Tomax and Zaymot, when they first came through.
That's awesome. Was that at Target, by the way?
Yes, this was at Target. Okay. I had to almost wrestle this out of some – talking about, like, stores not having things. Target, this is a Target exclusive. You can only get this. You could only get this at Target. You can't buy it anymore. You know how many my Target got altogether?
Wow.
Two. You live in the
Why
sticks.
Why so low?
No, I don't live in the sticks. Hmm. That's the problem,
you got,
man.
You got light bulbs out there?
I know. That's the problem. This makes it very hard to be a collector of things. That's why when I found those, found that Flint and Lady J earlier today, I actually found that at a Walmart in the sticks that like I wouldn't have normally gone to. But that's yeah, like
yeah. I grew up with the reason I joined the military. I joined the military because of two reasons: my dad, I was third generation, and GI Joe. Yeah,
Enosh, were you into Thundercats or are you more G.I. Joe and Transformers?
So I was into Thundercats, but I was more G.I. Joe, Transformers, Voltron, and Silverhawks. I did like
Wheeled Warriors. Remember the Wheeled Warriors?
I remember Wheeled Warriors. I wasn't too much into Wheeled Warriors, but I do remember I watched Thundercats,
Mask,
but I didn't have
Mask.
Oh, I was totally into Mask, dude. I got Mask stuff sitting around.
I had
here
the
right
playset.
I got all kinds of.
I
mask
had the playset. The Boulder
I have
station.
It. I have it. I got. I got a complete one, dude. I got it from a guy.
There's a pop. Does this pop stop off? The pop comes off.
Yeah, like I got the whole thing. Yes.
It? Oh man.
Yeah, I got. I just recently started getting into these statues and stuff.
I'm gonna raid your house.
But I'll tell you what. Let me tell you something. I watched Thundercats because I loved Thundercats, but I didn't have a lot of Thundercat toys, and I don't know why.
They didn't make a lot of toys for them.
My friend. There's only one version of Voltron. There's only one Voltron, and we all know.
Well, he's talking about the lions, and then that second version that came out with.
There's only one.
If you like Voltron, watch Battle of the Planets or watch Gotcha Man.
There's only one Voltron. Come on. Yeah. It's the lions. I got all my lions and everything in the other room, but
the concept for Voltron came from Gotcha Man.
I got stuff just sitting around here, man. You bring up Silverhawks, man. Look what I just have right here.
Oh jeez. Yeah, whoa. You showed me that before.
Everything at arm reach.
Hey, remember the guitars used to turn into their birds? Like the guitar turned into the birds for the one guy.
Well, that was the one guy. That was
Blue. You know what though? I'm actually curious. Do you have any real Ghostbusters toys? The cartoon.
I don't.
Wow, I'm sure.
I was because you know why? Because I wasn't that much into the cartoon.
Really?
I didn't.
It, but because, it was so good though.
I know. But I wasn't. Here, this is for Darren. Darren, I don't know if you've ever seen this.
What is that? Doomcock figure?
Yeah. You know who made that for me?
Who is this guy?
Bruce made this for me.
You bring him up a lot. Oh, I don't know who this is. Who is
I like that. Yeah.
He's a Star Wars.
You're not missing anything.
You're not missing anything.
You got to watch some Two Cents on Nonsense, William. You got to watch one of their streams when they do that.
Just make something news. I did a video on Starblade.
Does he look like that? Does he wear a face mask like that?
Yeah. That's the whole point.
A grown-ass man.
Well,
our good friend Mad Max wears a mask.
We believe.
Yeah, you know what? That's the dude.
There he is right there. There he is
right
there.
That's what he looks like?
Doomcock Proctology Center.
His videos, yes.
When it comes to crap, he's an expert. And don't forget, you know, if you're in trouble, take some Doom Enema from Crockett Johnson Industries when you need to flush all logic and sense. Remember, it's all Snoke and mirrors.
It looks like the thing from Devo. Remember Whip It?
Yeah, he wears the mask and he wears like the Music Man jacket like that. Yeah.
Oh, well, hey, everybody's got their thing.
Okay. I don't need to see this.
No, this is one of my favorite drops, man. Let me see if I can find the drop. Here's the actual drop. We call that one weird nonsense.
That is
exactly aptly named. Thank you.
Yep. The Mike Zero University of Grifting and Clickbait.
So is Mike Zero Doomcock?
No. I wouldn't even say they have a similar style. They've got something. I'm sorry, but Darren, what video did you say you made this week?
Oh, Star Blazers a couple weeks ago, and I didn't even know they made figures. They were Japanese figures.
But yeah, I love you can get Star the imports Blazers, too. You can get the imports. You can get the imports.
For that. Yeah, that's why I went over
the big old ship. Yeah, you can still get them if you order them through AAA out of LA if they still
but they
around.
Did figures like back 78, they did some action figures. That's like the size of Star Wars figures. I was like, man, if I knew that as a kid, that was
77, 78. There's a lot of old anime stuff. Macross. Macross is something that everybody, if you've watched Robotech and you haven't seen the original 1982 Macross, you're losing out, man. It's it's all of Robotech year one put into like a movie, basically. You know, whereas Robotech, when we saw it in America, they spread it out over seasons. But that was an underrated show. Robotech season two, the Invid. Oh man, when they after the Invid shock troopers tore up the planet, I watched that cartoon. Man, that was. Then that's what got me into Voltron and going back into the Gatchaman, Planet of the Battle of the Planets, where you know, all that stuff. Man,
Battle of Planets was good. Yeah.
Yeah, they Americanized it so for stupid idiots like me, but I loved it, man. You know,
it's like a show I used to Space Giants. I used to love it as a kid, and no one hardly ever remembers it, but. I went back and tried to watch it, and it was a Japanese show, and it was kind of like Power Rangers, I guess.
Yeah,
in the late '70s, and it's horrible.
Yeah, that stuff, all that colored, all that colored, you know, the blue, the red, the green, got a lot of that stuff. If you go back into the 1970s versions of anime, that's how they did things, and that's how they broke up their leadership. And,
well, I told this story before, but like I went on a quest to find some AEW toys. It took me months to find them in actual Walmart. Because they're exclusive, just like the Target Baroness toys.
Yeah. Oh, dude, you should have let me know.
They only have one. They have a Riho action figure still at Walmart. That one's not like, you know,
fly. That's because she wrestles 5 minutes a year. So it's not.
See, Stella knows. Stella knows.
I have a Kenny Omega and a Rey Fenix too, but I still got to get some more.
I got him, and I got him with the belt too, so now he has a belt.
I do want to make clear about I do want to make clear about Voltron though. Like I did watch both Voltrons. He's only giving credit to the lions.
I know.
Well, I thought it was hilarious when Robot Chicken poked fun at like how long it took the vehicle Voltron to like form, like where they're trying to come together and like they're like, oh wait a second, we did something out of sequence. Go back. Like
were you big into Power Rangers, Enosh, at all?
No. No,
we were a little bit older. We were in our 20s when
for me, I love Power Rangers. Like I love that stuff.
Yeah,
I watched it
as a grown man. I watched it. And like I said, my favorite episodes were the Green Ranger episodes. And then when everybody lost their crap, when he turned into the White Ranger, it was this big mystery. And then he takes his helmet off. You know, I remember buying that Green Ranger in the store. Great stuff. But hey, the funny thing about like with Transformers. No one ever criticizes the fact that, you know, when Megatron turns into a gun that a boombox can hold and they can both fit in your pocket. But when they transform, they're 10 feet tall. It was hilarious.
Hey, that's realistic.
Yeah,
it is.
They never really explained that, you know, how the tape, how a cassette tape shaped as a cougar could attack a grown man and carry him off. You know, I always thought it was but if we suspended our disbelief. You know, or how Unicorn is three different sizes and Transformers.
You know what? Actually, Zack, the wrestler, Zack Ryder, and Curt Hawkins.
He's hiding behind the corner here. Sorry. I was trying to. Oh, there he is.
You need the junk room. You know what I mean? Look like I have nothing. Yeah.
That's not the original one, though, right? That's the.
Yeah, no, that's the original one. I've got the reissued ones. This is the original one.
Okay, now that I see your hand, okay, it looked a lot bigger. What you put it, dude? I had that thing, and I didn't even transform it a lot. And the leg joints, like right where it's loose like that, I couldn't stand that. I thought that was a crime that the leg joints did that. And on all their Generation 1 stuff, it did that until they started making them out of plastic. These things were expensive when I was a kid. You know how much begging I had to get the old man to do that and lawns?
That's what I need. I need to get some classic wrestling figures. Because Zack Ryder and Curt Hawkins from formerly WWE, they have a YouTube channel where they go around the country finding old wrestling stuff. There's like some amazing toys they find.
I remember when they were the Edgeheads. Remember that when they first came onto the scene and they were all dressed like Edge and they kept jumping in the ring trying to fool the referee? They were funny,
man.
Yeah, he's got. Look at that. That is.
Are those
the Terror Dome? Is that the Terror Dome on the top?
Yeah, it's the Terror Dome right there.
Oh man,
they made Jaws toys.
Those are those new reactions.
Those are reissues though. They're still good though.
Yeah, they're pretty cool.
Those are the re-retros.
Colonel Sanders?
Yeah, that's my buddy Bruce's work too. There.
That's hilarious. Amazing.
And then all these clear ones are also Bruce.
I need you got to hook me up with Bruce. I need my life.
And then he made me a couple of droids.
I don't want to see the C-3PO with the dick.
Come on, you want to see that?
No, I don't. Not anymore.
This is a special 500th Boba Fett, because he knows I'm such a big Boba Fett fan. And that was his 500th figure that he ever made. And he actually surprised me with it. He was asking me, he's like, if I do a 500th figure, like, who should I do? And I was like, dude, you should do Boba Fett. And he's like, really? Should I? And I'm like, yeah. And he's like, well, should I do it with this smoky plastic, or should I do it with like regular plastic? And I'm like, oh, dude, you got to do it with smoky plastic. And then he's like, okay, well, like, what should I put? And he actually put on there that it's for Enosh. And
that's awesome.
Yeah, it was a super cool thing. But no, I got Elvis Akbar that Bruce made me.
That's fantastic.
The caught in a trap version.
You know what you need? You need to make a custom cereal box. This is Admiral Akbar cereal.
And then man. this is the one that he made me that is like legendary now. It's the
all the wrong reasons.
It's the Topps card. Oof. I think it's hilarious. I bought this from him. He didn't.
YouTube should make you blur that out, man. You shouldn't be allowed.
Why? It's goldenrod.
What? Yeah. It's sexual innuendo.
It's just a device he uses to plug into machines.
Hey, take that out of the box.
Don't let Daniel see it. He'll rip it up.
I will. You know why? I'll take this out of the box.
It slips out.
Well, let me show you
another.
Because all the things that Bruce makes, he makes with these special things here, where you can.
Now that's a guy that's I need to meet this guy.
Yeah. Man, I'm gonna have to give him hell next time he's in my live chat. I was like, I ain't never got nothing free.
Oh, okay. So it's like you can just like slip it right back on.
Oh yeah,
that's cool.
Slip it right back on. Slip it off. I bought that from him as soon as literally I saw him post it on eBay, and I was like, 2 seconds after I saw him post it on eBay, I was like, that must be mine. I'm going to buy that. And like, I bought it from him right then and there. He's like, are you sure? And I'm like, yeah, dude, I want that. I want that so bad. You don't even know. Like, I must have that. I must own that. No, you know how I got in touch with him is I bought something from him on eBay. I met him on eBay. Really? I met Bruce on eBay, and I bought like these Boba Fett, some of his Boba Fett stuff. And I just was like, you know what? Dude, I got this YouTube channel. I said, you know, would you be interested in like, you know, coming on and like talking about your stuff? And he was like, yeah, man. And so he came on, and I this was like early days of me even being able to have anybody on. And we did this whole thing, and I put it on Facebook originally. I had to download it from Facebook literally to get it, because it was before all this. And I did that, but we talked, and I gave his information out, and he ended up losing his job. And it was around Christmas time though, but he said, this is how great this community is here at the Poindexter Lounge. 'Cause I had no idea. We put that out there. We showed some of the toys that he had made and everything. And apparently people responded in such a way and bought stuff from him that it made his family's Christmas, he said. And I was what? And then he turned around and, later on that year, like he said that he had been very successful, and he said that he ranked it up to the Poindexter Lounge, you know, having him on and helping him and stuff. And I was just like, dude, I'm blown away by that. I said, I don't even know like what to say to that, man, you know, because like I said, you know, we're in the bigger scheme of things, we're a little blip, you know, but there's a lot of great people here. And right, yeah. And I'm very thankful for that, you know. So that's why anytime somebody tries to come at me and try to be negative, I'm gonna have to, I gotta plug this back in. Hold on just a second. But anytime somebody tries to come at me and be negative about something, I'm just like, whatever. Yeah. Like this is a great community of people.
Yeah, I'm just curious, Junk Man, that Obi-Wan thing behind you, is like a stand-in or what is that? I'm just curious. Like, is it like a hello?
It's a banner. It was the hanging Walmart.
Okay. Yeah. Oh, okay, that's awesome.
Yeah, I had a bunch of them, but I don't know what I did with them. I worked for a company that put them in the stores back when they came out on VHS or DVD, probably. And I had tons of them in the attic. Still in the boxes, the Fox shipping boxes. I think I threw them away when I moved. I hope not.
Benson's here. Mark over in the UK says, with a £2 super chat, thank you, Mark, says Netflix making a Battle of the Planets live movie.
Yeah, I heard about that. Heard about that.
I know they're doing the Gundam movie with Jordan Voight Roberts. So
yeah, that's going to be a tough one. They got a lot. They the people who are into Gundam are super particular. So I hope that goes. Yeah, that's not an easy going punch.
Here, Darth Tasty says, I actually gave Bruce the idea for the two-tone cape. I love that C-3PO figure. I have one myself. Which figure? Because I know that this is Ryan here, and Ryan knows Bruce. And I'm trying to think of which figure you're talking about with the two-tone cape. I don't know. No, he made me. He also made a Mandalorian for me before.
Looks really good.
Yeah, he did a really good version. He actually, of course, and made me a little baby Yoda. Grogu.
That's awesome.
Little baby Grogu. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's fun. I love stuff like that. You know, I love toys. I've said it many times. It's like how can you be upset about anything? Wait.
You love toys?
I do.
I would have never guessed.
I know. Do, I mean, you shocked me right there, man.
I do, man. I do. That's why I love your channel, Darren, because I love you. I love the stuff that you do. But I love some of the videos you put together, man. I'll tell you what. I understand that editing thing, man, and you get frustrated because maybe they don't all blow up the way you think they will. But I'll tell you what, man. I enjoy your content, and I tell people about your content all the time. And your coverage of toys and like random stuff that I've never even seen before sometimes. And I'm just like, wow, like nobody else is doing content. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like that, you know, like,
well, that's why I try to be unique. And it's hard doing a video every day too. So you know how that is.
Mm-hmm.
Monday through
mm-hmm.
Friday and live stream every day.
Yeah. It's hard, man.
But so I appreciate that. But yeah, my goal is always to make you say, oh, I remember that. Or, I didn't know about that. And that's my two goals usually.
Those are good goals.
I shared one night after you did it. I was telling people to go over and watch your video about it. But that I remember distinctly there was something that I just like my mouth dropped wide open. I was like, I know a lot of stuff about like Star Wars, stuff around the fandom and stuff around, you know, that happened or whatever. But I had no idea that video that you did about the guy who was like duped.
That's the one I really thought would blow up, and it didn't. It's never. Dude, really. I mean, that should be a documentary. That whole story should be a lot more known. The guy that thought he made friends with George Lucas.
Yeah.
And then,
that's crazy.
I've never heard of this story before. So
no, nobody. That's up. Why. I can't remember. Let me see what the name of it is. But I don't want to give too much away because it's fun to watch. But yes. He started writing George Lucas, and he started sending what he wanted to see in the movies, and started working with him for Return of the Jedi. But then it turned out to be a big con.
Oh man!
Yeah, it has a dark ending to it too.
Very dark ending to it. I mean, it's like one of the like. I'm surprised Matt Jarbo didn't jump on that one and do one of his true crime stories on that one because, my God,
don't get many.
That's why I thought it would blow up more. I really did.
Can I say that I love William's profile picture? Like, I'm jealous of that man right now.
Look at William hanging out with a bunch of ladies there. Bunch of Harleys.
Anybody's looking for it, it's called thatjumpman.com. It's called The Lost Tomorrow's Dreams of a Child Jedi. And see, it only has 2,000 views.
So. Yeah, here, I will, this is what I'm going to do. I am going to
And that's, post I mean, that's 2,000 views in 2 years.
I know, and it's such a great story, man. And it was such a
that's going to blow up. And nobody, I was like, I bet if Star Wars explained this story, everybody would be talking about it.
Exactly, right? Now, what was that called again? Was that called? I'll put a link to it.
I can send you a link if you want. Okay. The Forgotten, The Lost Tomorrows, Dream of a Jedi, Dreams of a Child Jedi. If you can't find it, I got the link right here. If you want me,
I got it right here. So I will share it with everyone. I'm telling you what, guys. Plus, I love your openings, man. Your Filmation.
Guy made that for me, and I was going to use it once, and I loved it. I had to.
Oh, it's fantastic. But guys, go check this out.
As soon as the stream ends, I'm going to have to check out this video. It looks really interesting.
Yeah, it's only 12 minutes too, so it's a quick watch. Darcy, and I did make it 2 years ago. It'll probably be better today.
Farsi B, I do not have one yet. Answer your question.
Are you thinking of making 1 million?
Yeah.
Yeah. Is it going to be more so like sitting around like the sci-fi center or like more like opinion pieces?
It's going to be, well, no, well, it's going to be informational stuff that the reason to do certain things, like, okay, like I was telling you before, the first one's going to be five reboot proof stories that you can jump into because of the reboots that pretty much ruined everybody's lives.
Oh, yeah, for comic books, yeah.
Yeah, and then it'll be things that are centered around conversations that you would have at the Sci-Fi Center, but not necessarily on the center itself, because, like I said, there's a lot of people who will see it and may never come down there, so I want to make it relatable to them as well.
There we go. I put links to both that video. I know, right? I put links to both that video from that junk man and also from also his channel there. So that you guys
can go. Now I go to junkman.com to anybody.
Oh yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. So cool. great content. Love it. Love it. Love it. Love it.
Driving right now.
Awesome. Awesome. Well, hey guys, this was fun. I'm glad that we had this time to chill tonight and just kind of nerd out on some stuff, especially here at the end. That's always fun. Why don't we go around the horn and just kind of, I know, RJ, we just promoted other stuff, but RJ, why don't you tell people where they can find you, sir?
Yeah, absolutely. So you can find me on Twitter at Resident Justice. It's right there.
Oops. And I took it away just as you said it. I totally didn't mean to do that.
No, it's okay. Right there, Resident Justice. So that's how you spell it. I'm on Twitter, and I'm also on YouTube. Throw a quick link the chat to my channel. And yeah, I just, you know, I did a stream earlier today talking about the Wayne Carr Green Lantern stuff and all that too.
I stalked that one too, damn it.
Yeah, you came. It was so funny. So I was about to end the string. It's like, oh, okay, Jarbo left, everything's fine. We're winding things down. Then William came on and I was like, oh, shoot. And we went off for like another 45 minutes. And I was, because I had my pizza arrived, right? So William came on. It's like, I don't want to end the string because I love talking to William. But it's like, I got my pizza's getting cold. So it's like,
I got to hear 45 minutes about this microwave pizza or something like that, and I'm like,
what? No, it was pizza I ordered. Like,
okay, they were saying it was microwave. I'm Viagra for the end of your stream. I extend things.
I do that? No, but it was a great conversation. I'm the blue pill.
There you go. There you go. And William, tell people where they can find you. I know you don't have a YouTube channel yet, but tell them where they can find your business out in Vegas.
Just Google the Sci-Fi Center. It's going to be the first and only thing that comes up. And just click on any of those things and you'll see me dressed and stuff like this. You know, the first one you see that
I might be going to Vegas in July, by the way.
If I do, it's gonna be hot as hell.
Oh, it will be, but
God, it's gonna, your brain's gonna boil inside the skull, you know. But hey, you're gonna have fun though. Right. Yeah, just Google the Sci-Fi Center, go on sci-ficenter.com and click on any of the social media there. And like I said, soon I'll have a YouTube page. I'm just putting together the content right now.
Sure. And Darren, why don't you tell us anything that you're working on? I know you got a thing tomorrow night that hopefully I can be a part of. And so,
yeah, we've been playing, been a lot of fun with the chat room. We've been playing Pop Culture Jeopardy. Mondays is Star Wars night. Wow. So we're going to do, yeah, it's really fun. So like, I'm going to try to get some people. Fun. Yeah, I'm going to try to get, I usually open up for the chat. The chat answers the questions. We might give away a prize, but I'm going to try Monday. To get three or four people to join me and kind of do it like you're doing here and see how that works out. So we do that 7 o'clock every Monday through Friday.
What time zone?
5 o'clock around Eastern.
Eastern
at 7. And then at around 5, I have my daily video. So you can just go to thatjunkman.com. That'll take you to my YouTube channel or junkmanmerch.com and get a shirt. So
there you go. There you go. Well, hey, guys, thank you for joining us. Thank you to everyone in the chat. Thank you again. I always like to say thank you to all of our mods. You guys earned your keep. Hey, look, Bruce showed up. What's up, Bruce? We've been talking about
now you. Now he's man. Here. Now we'll be on
our This was the Bruce episode, Jenner. Bruce. This was where your worlds collide, man. This is where, like, you know, the streamers that you like start coming together, man. This
is where I found out he's been giving you toys and hadn't gave me anything.
I was showing him, man. I was showing him all the toys, man. I was showing him all the good
and
stuff.
And Justin Proper's here, too. He's asking to bring up, back Justin? Eddie.
Bring back Eddie. We need to bring back Eddie.
I would put something, you know, if he sent me something, you know, I'd put it up there and say, hey, look at this.
He had a piano gig tonight. He had a piano gig tonight.
Piano gig, man, he does everything.
Wow, damn.
Oh, Justin,
I haven't heard that one. Yeah,
Justin, no, hey. No.
Okay,
hold on. I got a drop for Justin. Hold on, before we go, we do anything else.
Do you hear that? Listen, even Grandma in heaven is booing you right now.
Hey. between the two lead singers, not including Gary Cherone, Sammy was better.
He is clarified. He's only joking.
Which is a shame because, you know what? Out of all of them, Gary Cherone is probably the best singer, hands down.
Yeah. Yeah.
But he just wasn't a good fit. He was just never a good fit for Van Halen.
And plus, he was, after what happened and how Sammy was kind of booted, he was never going to be given a chance.
No.
But not. But Sammy was better. Van Hagar, 86 to 97. Only
no, man, David Lee Roth. No, David Lee Roth is the quintessential front man. He's crazy as all get up, but it's like three different bands. Okay, the first one is Van Halen. That's Van Halen. Band. Look, dude, that's a party band. You got Hot for Teacher. You got Jump. You got Beautiful Girls. You got, I mean, there's too many songs, right? There's just too many songs to even get into that. But I mean, that's the Van Halen band. Then you got Van Hagar, absolutely. And Van Hagar,
musical band.
Van Hagar is the musical band, is the polished, amazing quality, good singer. Van Halen out for grown-ups
is what I call it.
Exactly. And then that Gary Cherone thing is like it's Van Hagar without really good songs, and Gary Cherone for some reason trying to be Sammy Hagar instead of just being himself. Because I love Extreme. One of my favorite albums is Three Sides to Every Story by Extreme. If you haven't listened to it, buy it. Listen to it from beginning to end.
Pornograffiti's the best.
Pornograffiti's cool, but Three Sides to Every Story is like a rock opera almost. It tells a story from beginning, and it's got great songs. They weren't commercially successful, but listen, as a longtime musician, I will just tell you, they're great songs. They're really good songs.
I got good play with the crappiest song that they ever released, that More Than Words thing that made me want to eat my own vomit. Hated that song.
I just heard More Than Words in the store the other day, and I was singing it, man. I still love that song. I still love that song. Now, see, look at Justin Proper coming in here like at the last minute trying to get us off. I'm trying to wind things down. He's getting started on Van Halen.
He's late, but he's right.
That'll be another 20.
I know. But hey, no, guys, I appreciate you guys all coming in here and talking to me tonight and having some fun with me. And I hope that all of you guys had fun. Like I said, thank you again to all of our mods. You guys are fantastic. And you're always on top of stuff, you know, when people try to come in and cause trouble, we shut it down. And so I'm thankful to all of you. Thankful to Darren, the Junk Man. Thankful to RJ. Thankful to William. You guys are awesome. We'll definitely have to do some more stuff together. And Darren, I'm glad that you're able to jump in here, man. And I look forward
to it. Yeah, glad to finally get on.
Absolutely. All right, guys. Like I always tell you, don't let anybody tell you that your fandom doesn't matter. And don't tell anybody that their fandom doesn't matter. But try to have good conversations. Have some fun. Don't take yourself too seriously. But please, most of all, treat everybody with respect. And if you do that, you'll always have a place here in the Poindexter Lounge. Until next time, stay nerdy. Bye-bye.